Good evening, and welcome to the second of three, free candidate question time sessions. This session is VP Education, followed by VP Activities. I'm your host, Liam Mayer, and I'm co-hosting with my colleague in the Student Media Centre, Matthew Hudson. How are you doing, Matthew?
I'm doing well, thank you, Liam. And I will be feedbacking your questions, which you will submit through Twitter, to the candidates, something I'm looking forward to doing throughout the evening. I shall be doing it on this screen here. I will be scrolling through, and you can see your questions appear on this screen throughout the evening.
That's great to hear, Matthew. Speaking of questions, there are two ways to make sure that you get your questions answered. The first way is to go through the Kent Union website. That's kentunion.co.uk/leadership-elections. The second way is through Twitter, where you can use our Twitter handle, @Kent_TV, and make sure when you ask your questions, if you wish to specify a candidate, that you use their name in the question, and also you follow it with the hashtag CQTEducation or CQTActivities. So, without further ado, let's get started with the VP Education. So, let's see what the VP Education actually does.
Thanks for coming in, Jack.
It's okay.
So you've been VP for Education for two terms now. So can you give us a brief overview of what the VP for Education is responsible for? What do you do?
The Vice President of Education is the lead officer for kind of education policy, or basically representing students on any education issues, that's learning, teaching, anything kind of academic you do with your studies. So everything that's not extracurricular would also be a way to explain it, I guess. You're also lead officer supporting the 350 course reps, who are kind of the soldiers who represent students on a day-to-day basis and making sure they're empowered to do their jobs.
Okay, so that's quite a varied list of things that you do.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say is the responsibility you enjoy doing the most?
My favourite part of the role is representing students to university, so especially in senior management, because I think actually when you're the Vice Chancellor, the Pro Vice Chancellor, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, you can get quite, I guess, aloof from perhaps students or student issues. So it's really nice to be able to explain to them what the current student is thinking and how they're kind of, what's happening at the moment is affecting them. And that's a bit I enjoy. And I've developed quite strong relationships there, I think, and made a difference.
Okay, so it's your second term, so you've gone mm-hmm. through two campaigning seasons.
Yes.
So how did you find campaigning?
I feel like it made me 5 years older straight away. It was one of my best experiences of my life, getting elected two times, like, absolutely fantastic, but it's so much work. Like, I'd recommend it to anyone though, but it's so tough. You're out 7 days in a row in cold, rain, wind, snow, whatever, trying to convince students to vote for you, and it's really, really, really tough, but such a rewarding experience at the end as well.
Okay, so if you could give any advice to the current candidates campaigning, what would that advice be?
Be yourself, I think, and be honest as well. I think when, in my first year on the election hustings, I got a question that I had no idea what the answer was, and I actually tried to blag it, and I think I would not do that. My advice would be just to be honest and upfront and say you don't know and you'll get back to them. I think that's so much more genuine and provides students actually with a bit of your personality rather than trying to blag things. So I think whenever you're talking to any student, voter or whatever, just being yourself, I think, is absolutely important, because you'll get elected on that and that's how you'll be in your role. So I think it's important for students to do that before you get elected.
So what would you say is going to be the hottest topic for education? What's the big issue that people should be focusing on?
There's so many. I mean, there's lots of national stuff going on at the moment about the teacher excellence framework, potentially tuition fees are going to rise in the next 2 to 3 years, depending on when it is implemented. So something around that is potentially a really big issue, but also I think timetabling at the moment is a really, really big problem for students, affecting a lot of students' lives, so maybe those are the main two. I think there's so much that kind of needs to happen, needs to be improved at the moment, so I'd be anything really.
Okay, so finally, if your successor was to watch this, mm-hmm. what advice would you give them now that they're in the role? What's your closing advice?
I think listen to staff and listen to students and listen to the university as well. I think when you come in, you don't know, when you're running, you don't know what you don't know, but when you start, there's so much you don't know, and it takes you so long to get up to speed with how the timetabling system works, how modules are approved, how a billion different things, really. And I think spending some time understanding how that stuff works, and it takes 2, 3, 4 weeks, sometimes half my first year I still didn't understand things, but understanding those kind of operational and how that stuff happens enables you to make change a lot quicker rather than kind of blustering in and then getting caught out by not really understanding the processes. So that would be my advice.
Okay, and finally, what are you most proud of achieving? What have you done that you think, I'm glad I did that?
I think, to be honest, the overall thing I'm proud of achieving is implementing like nearly all of my manifesto. I think lots of people run on manifestos, and to be honest, some stuff gets dropped, some stuff doesn't happen, but I think I've implemented or made considerable steps towards nearly all of it. So I think specifically maybe examination feedback, something I talked about massively in both my election and re-election campaign, and at the time of filming, it hasn't been announced that it's going to happen, but when this is released, my blog will go up, I hope. So if not, it's exclusive. Students will be getting examination feedback, and that's one thing, and also the 24/7 library in Templeman, I think it's been a really, really big change, and loads of students have had an impact on it. So those are the main two I'd suggest.
Okay, fantastic.
And that was the VP for Education. Now for you to watch a short clip to make sure that you know who the education candidates are.
Hi, I'm Dev Kokoza and I'm running for VP Education. My main policy points are lecture recordings of all schools, free Wednesdays and a free breakfast in exam season. Count Kokoza.
Hi, my name's Andreas Payne. I'm running to be your Vice President of Education. I want more flexible learning, I want more study space, and I want academic unity. Remember, no pain, no gain.
Alex Johnson, Education. Expand the bursaries, reform timetables, and improve online resources. Join Johnson.
Hey, I'm Stuart, and I'm running for VP Education. Vote for me for degree equality, January exams, and to get rid of additional course costs. So, stand with Stuart.
Okay. So now we're going to get on to the candidate speeches. So here are the rules. You're going to have 2 minutes, and you're going to get a 30-second warning, which will be me raising my card like so, and then I'm going to give you a 10-second verbal warning. If you go over time, I will unfortunately have to cut you off. Alexander, you're up first. Please take the podium.
Hi there. I'm Alex, and I'm running to be your next VP for Education. I'll get right into this and try and keep it short and outline some of the key points for my manifesto. If elected, I'll lobby for improvements to the bursary system already available to some students at Kent. The aim of this would be to change the boundaries of where this becomes available, allowing a broader group of students a bit more financial aid for their educational needs, i.e. filling in the substantial gap left by the abolition of maintenance grants. I'll also work towards improving the use and availability of electronic resources, ensuring more lectures are recorded, and that lecture notes or presentation slides always make it onto Moodle. There will also be some timetable reforms so as to reduce instances wherein students are forced out of their preferred modules due to clashes. And I'll try and develop a greater number of optional modules specifically geared toward the idea of your degree in the real world to help you when you leave this university. And more, obviously, but hopefully my stance on a variety of issues will be covered by tonight's question time. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex. Andreas, you're next. Take the podium. Once again, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you and good evening. I'm running to be your Vice President Education on a platform of three key principles: flexible learning, academic unity, and study space. Flexible learning stems from my own experiences here at Kent. I want to conduct a complete review of how we're assessed at Kent and explore the possibilities of being able to swap exams for coursework and vice versa. Increased flexibility is about getting as many lectures recorded as possible, earlier exam timetables, academic credit for volunteering, and the continuation of freeing Wednesdays for sports and activities. In addition, I want to bring academic societies, course reps, and academic schools closer together, so if they wish, they can work to enhance student learning and student satisfaction jointly. Academic unity focuses on bringing students together. Our friends at Medway are currently not able to access the same resources as those of us at Canterbury, recognising that postgraduates' needs are different to those of undergraduates, and making sure that free print credits are given to all students. I work on behalf of all of these students to correct these imbalances. Finally, on the issue about study space, the short answer is that we need more. Our library has a fantastic new extension, but work on the rest of it is causing problems, which I will lobby to keep to a minimum. I will also push to create more study space in colleges and refurbish what already exists. And most ambitiously, I want to create a city centre study hub. Working with the county and city councils, the university and others, I believe we can create a first-class study centre in town that has all the facilities that a study hub on campus would. They're ambitious plans, but I think I have the experience and the drive to achieve them. I've done a lot in my time as Elliott College president, against a lot of resistance as well. And if I can do that as a part-time officer, imagine what I can do as your Vice President Education. Just remember, no pain, no gain.
Thank you very much, Andreas. Dave Kokoza, can you please take the podium? Remember, 2 minutes.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Dave Kokoza, and you may recognise me from the parody videos I've produced. You might have been expecting me to use a speech to a recital of my Hotline Bling parody. But whilst the video has been a fantastic way of showing student politics can be engaging for everyone, something I will take forward into the role, I want to use this time to show you that I'm extremely serious about what I want to undertake. I faced criticism for the fact I didn't pass my third year. I've had to retake it. Last year I had a plethora of health issues, including pneumonia and a serious back injury that required an operation. All of this took its toll on me, and frankly the support was not there for me to pass. I appreciate how hard it can be for some students to complete their studies, and it was a struggle that this has empowered me to run for your VP Education and to make education accessible for everyone. My policies are built upon my experiences. During my time off, catching up with the work I miss has been a long process. That's why I would lobby to introduce lecture recordings across all schools, to not only aid students as a revision tool, but to ensure those who need adjustments to their learning have the same experience as everyone else. Exams are a stressful time for everyone, and as part of a wider initiative to improve support for students, I will introduce a free healthy breakfast during the final term. It's been done at Leeds, and it can be done here at Kent. I'll also lobby the university for more social study space, so that everyone has the opportunity to study how they choose to. I want to channel the frustration I've experienced with the system into improving the lives of all students. Whilst I am now trapped into graduating with a 2-2 at best, largely part to the university not understanding the issues I've had to face, I can still use my time here at Kent to make a massive change. I want to improve the student support available for students with independent learning plans, and I promise that never again will a student have to deal with fighting for their degree on top of dealing with so much already. 2 minutes is not enough time to even begin telling you my story and what I want to achieve, so I hope you'll take the time to read my manifesto, because I will promise I will be the most passionate and hardworking VP Education the union has ever seen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dave. Stuart, it's your turn to take the podium.
Hello, I'm Stuart and I'm running for your VP Education. Since arriving at Kent, I have been dissatisfied with the quality of my degree, and I know a lot of people out there feel the same. To combat these issues, I became an academic course rep in my first year and then society president to try and get my views across to my department. I've attended many departmental meetings and managed to win some trip bursaries for my department. This is a small win compared to what I want to do overall. If elected, I would want this university to be held to a higher degree of quality for degrees and bring the smaller schools in line with the larger ones in a process of standardisation across the university. I plan on doing this in a number of ways, such as student-led Facebook group to support first years with support from second and third years, increase feedback and make it to a higher quality, introduce regular quality checks and academic advisors. I would also like to introduce recorded lectures, far more than the current amount. Also, I would like to start to bring the university into the modern age by introducing new types of assessments such as Twitter, blogs and Facebook pages to increase employability skills. I will actively try and make sure all coursework positions are filled, introduce December and January exams, get book vouchers for students and an increase in resources in the library via a book repository scheme where second and third years can give their books to the library so future students can use them. And finally, I would like to keep my work with the academic societies and make sure they are recommended by the department. If you feel strongly about any of these points, then stand with Stuart.
Thank you very much, Stuart. Okay, so now that you've all heard their speeches, I believe you and I both agree that we probably want to drill in a little bit deeper. So now we're going to start with the questions. We have two group questions to begin with, so this will be applied to all four of you candidates. The first question is as follows. Who should ultimately pay for higher education? Alexander, if you would like to answer first.
Personally, I believe that education should be free. Unfortunately, that's probably quite unrealistic, so some contribution should be made. However, I think it's the university's job, and their obligation, in fact, to help poor students make sure their education is no less off for the fact that their parents were perhaps not well off.
Thank you very much. Andreas, you're up next.
Thank you. I personally support the idea of graduate tax. I feel that this is a good and sensible way to help pay for higher education. Not everyone goes to university, and there are certainly other schemes available, such as apprenticeships, that are excellent. But I feel a graduate tax would be the best way for that. As a VP education, I would make sure that students get the best value for their current £9,000 tuition fees and make sure that that is money well spent and they feel that they're getting best value for money for that.
Okay, thank you. Dave, you're next.
Okay, so there's a few issues here. My own personal view is that education is something that is the right for everyone, and so it should be borne under the state, so it's free education, I believe in personally. But student views are some are different. And my role as VP Education is not to influence, in some ways, the government policy, it's to stand for students here at Kent. So I have my own personal opinions, which I believe, and I hold these beliefs for a long time, that education is a right for everyone. And the more that you learn, the better your overall life experience will be. So that's why I support free education, and I would fight always for that right. But student views will always differ, and I always will take that on board when it comes to campaigning at Kent Union.
Thank you very much, Dave. Stuart, your turn.
Like Alex and Dave said, I also believe that education should be free, or at least as much as you can, as cheap as it can be, to be sustainable. So I also believe the government should pay or help students. The cut to the maintenance grants I was not particularly pleased about, but unfortunately there's nothing I can do. A lot of my manifesto policies are trying to get more value for money for students in their degrees, such as book vouchers and print credits, and even recorded lectures. So also by reducing hidden course costs, I should help. Reducing hidden course costs, I should also help be able to help the poorer students that can't afford everything.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. And for our second group question, VP Education spends a lot of time in university meetings. How will you create an effective working relationship with the university staff? Stuart, if you could answer first.
I already have an effective relationship with the university staff. I've worked very closely with my department for the last 3 years to make sure that my degree and degrees of the people in my year, they're good quality. And I really want to make sure that that is implemented across all departments. I love working with my department. They're great people, really interesting. And some interesting personalities in there as well. So, yeah, I would... What was the question again?
The question is, VP Education spends a lot of time in university meetings. How will you create effective working relationship with the university staff?
Cool. So, yeah, I already...
And also 30-second warning.
Okay, I already have the active relationship with the university staff. I know quite a lot of higher-ups, the Deputy Vice Chair and Deputy Dean, so I already have those relationships.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. Dave, it's your turn.
So in my 3 years here at Kent, I've been a part-time officer, I've worked for the University of the Union, and I've built a lot of relationships up. It's something that I have sort of comes naturally to me. I was a sales manager for a bit of time before I came to university, and you know, forming relationships with new people was kind of my thing. I love doing it. I love meeting new people and kind of trying to influence them around to ideas. So for me, I've put myself out there on campus quite a lot, and I already know most of the university staff, particularly in the positions that I'll be going for as education. So the relationship's already starting to be there. The most important part for VP education for me is having these relationships and then being able to influence rather than, you know, stand back and let the university tell what they're going to do and not me have any say. So it's important for me to ensure that all students has a voice through me. So building relationships are very important, but it's not all my view that goes through. So it goes in tandem to say, oh, I have to build relationships with all the course reps and everyone that's involved in Ken Union. And I think I can do that.
Thank you very much, Dave. Andreas, it's your turn.
Thank you. Relationships are vital. There's no doubt about that. As a politics student, I study essentially the relationships between countries and heads of state. Over the past 2 years, I've been Elliott College president. I've met a number of key university staff and got to know a number of people in the union. In my time as college president, I've also got a lot done against a lot of resistance. So introducing the bed and flex scheme was not a popular issue. But by working on one-on-one relationships with members of staff, by being the reasonable negotiating person, you can stand up for students' views and get your point across, but maintain a cordial relationship. That's key as a vice president of education. It's something I would bring to the role and I think I would do very well.
Okay, thank you very much, Andreas. Finally, Alexander.
As I understand it, there's already a substantial infrastructure for meetings, specifically for education. But I think meetings can sometimes be counterproductive. So as much as I enjoy meetings, and I would do them, obviously, also reaching out to heads of schools and even lecturers on a one-to-one basis and making sure their needs are met and that their students' needs are met, I think it would be very important.
Thank you very much, Alexander. So, now that we've had two group questions, we're now going to see if Matthew has any questions that you've been asking. Got anything, Matthew?
Thank you, Liam. And I shall now move over to the screen over here where we have our high-tech question things. And the first question is for Andreas Payne, and it is, do you know why the library exit facing Grimmond is not yet accessible to students, and what are you planning to do to change this?
Okay, Andreas?
Thank you. It's a great question, and it's a frustration that a lot of students, including myself, have experienced. There's a back door right by Grimmond, and if you've got a seminar and want to go straight to the library, you can't get into it. It's a real shame. From what I understand, the reason that's been given is to do around the builders. However, when I pass, I don't see any builders in that particular area. Whether that's the case or not remains to be seen, and as your Vice President of Education, I would really push for that. It's the small things often that can make a really big difference to students' lives. And something like easier access to the library is one of those. So once I've determined the actual root cause of the problem, whether or not it is builders, I can then work out the best way to combat it. I hope that answers whoever sent in that questions, concerns. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Andreas. So have we got anything else, Matthew?
Yes, we have one for Alexander Johnson. And this is on the more universal teacher training level. Please can you expand on what you mean by successful teaching styles? How can you ensure that student will provide feedback on this?
In the course of research for my manifesto, I approached many of my friends who are among different schools. One of them, in fact, is a member of two schools, technically. And he noticed that between each of the different lectures, they were vastly different, not in terms of content, but in the fact that it was entirely different how he was taught, and one of his lectures was very good and the other was terrible. I don't agree with that. I think if a universal teaching level was introduced, that's much better. For instance, I have postgraduate students teaching me, and they sometimes seem a little under-informed as to how they should proceed, and that needs to be improved.
Thank you very much, Alex. Okay, anything else, Matthew?
Yes, we have one for Dave Kokosa. How would you distribute the free breakfast? Is it only on the day of the exam? Where is it going to take place? And how to deal with dietary restrictions?
Dave?
Okay, so this is a long question for 1 minute, but let me tell you about the free breakfast ideas. So if you haven't seen my page today, I've put up a very brief poly explanation on facebook.com/Coco for education. That kind of explains this idea in a bit more detail. The University of Leeds is somewhere that already distributes free breakfast throughout the exam period for an hour each day. And they offer bacon baps and sausage rolls, something that I want to do particularly, something a bit more healthier.
With regards to specific dietary requirements, I think this needs to be something that is worked into the plan. And really, I can only start getting these plans in place by having the conversations with the university whilst in office. I can promise the end of the world right now. It may not be 100% deliverable, but my plan, I know, on the basis of what it is deliverable. The actual final workings need to be something that I need to do in office.
10-second one. Okay, thank you very much, Dave. Okay, so anything else, Matthew?
Yes, we also have a question for Stuart Lidbetter, and that is, on student-led Facebook groups for student support for all degrees, how will people who don't have a Facebook account and do not wish to join the site get the opportunity to receive the information that is distributed on this site and address problems that they might encounter?
Stuart?
Ultimately, if you don't have Facebook, you probably won't get the full advantage of this site. You could perhaps get Facebook just for the site. I was also toying with the idea, I've been talking to academics about doing an email drop-in system where lecturers will reply to their emails really quickly within a specific 1 hour, a week time period for students that don't have Facebook like that. And I think that would be how I would deal with it.
Okay, so have we got anything else for our candidates, Matthew?
Yes, Liam, we have another question for Dave. This one is, do you think less people would turn up to lectures if they were recorded?
Okay, so this question kind of assumes that if lectures are recorded, people won't want to turn up. But my argument is, this is about bettering the experience for every student. So there are some students that need to have a bit more time for themselves for disability reasons, for ILPs that have mental health issues. I've experienced from myself particularly anxiety, and it struggled for me from my university experience. No, I don't think, as long as you introduce registers and lectures, something that is already done in most schools, this shouldn't impact on the attendance of lectures. And at the end of the day, if you record a lecture, having that availability of information online at a later date is ultimately going to be a better idea and better for all students. So I think the argument is there, but I don't think it will make a massive impact. I think the benefit outweighs the possibility of less people turning up to lectures.
Thank you, Dave. Just to follow up, do you not think that maybe there's any other alternative ways to do what it is you say that you want to do with the recordings?
I mean, possibly there is, but it's a question whether, when I was off ill, for example, some of my friends recorded the lectures for me, but that's putting the onus on someone else when really it should be the university that's adapting to suit my needs as an individual. So there are other ways, but I think it's the onus should be on the university of recording lectures as opposed to someone else doing it or having the lecture slides on Moodle when you miss out on learning information. I think the lecture recording benefits outweigh the possibility of other ideas. So I don't think there is a better way of doing it other than lectures being recorded.
Okay, thank you very much, Dave. So you've got anything else for us, Matthew?
Yes, I do, Liam. I have a question here for Stuart Lidbetter, which is, how will the book vouchers paid for by the tuition fees be distributed to the students? Will it be the same amount for everyone in the same course? Will you have to apply for them, or will you receive them automatically?
So,
Stuart?
So this is a kind of a complex issue. It is definitely doable. I've talked to many academics about it, as well as Jack Lay. It would probably have to start small and work up. My initial plan is to get them for students doing dissertation works, because sometimes books that they need aren't always in the libraries, which also links into my book repository scheme. When they're finished with them, if they could donate them back to the libraries, then they would be available for future years. Yeah, so ultimately, it would be for dissertation to start with, but I would aim to get it to as many students as I could possibly get. It has been done. It's been done at this university before. It's totally achievable.
Okay, just to follow up, how would you propose doing this, considering some books are in excess of £100?
Oh, toughy. So, obviously, my initial plan is to start with about £50 of book vouchers, so obviously you wouldn't be able to purchase a £100 book from £50 of book vouchers. They'd have to subsidise the rest themselves, maybe, but still, it's still £50 off that book if you did really require it. It would be cheaper. And hopefully, over time, it might be able to grow, or we can put more funds into online resources, making these textbooks more available.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. What else you got for us, Matt?
I also have a question here for Andreas Payne, which is where in the city centre would you like the off-campus study hub to be? Does the university have property there? And if not, how is the hub, security maintenance-wise, security maintenance going to be funded?
It's a great question, and it certainly is going off to the most ambitious point in my manifesto. The university doesn't have a huge amount of property other than on campus. Obviously, we have our satellite sites. But it's something that the university is keen to do. They like to do a lot of outreach, and based on that outreach, I think the university would be keen to negotiate talks with the council, with both city and county, and find a site. There are plenty of empty premises available in Canterbury. Which particular one? Well, that remains to be seen. That would be part of negotiations. In terms of maintenance and security, they are costs that, yes, have to be all factored in. However, I don't think they are out of the realm of possibility. I think this could be a great advancement for students and actually help the university promote its outreach work, which can be done in conjunction with the council, both of which are very keen to see more of this happen. It would benefit students, it would benefit the community, and benefit the university. So I can't see why it's not possible.
Okay, thank you very much, Andreas. Just to follow up, considering the current economic climate and the prices of properties, especially in Canterbury, how do you propose that we find the funds to attain and renovate such property for such use?
Funds are always the magic one here. With our university, there is a lot of revenue that comes in, and it's about allocation of those funds and what would be seen as the best priority both for both the students and the university. There's been a lot of criticism, for example, about accommodation only catering to the needs of conferencing rather than the needs of students. As a VP education, you have to put the argument forward that, one, yes, it would be firstly beneficial for students, but the university would be able to benefit from it in other means as well. Once you've made that argument, and I feel I can make that argument, then the funds can be found. They are there and in place, so I think it would be possible.
Thank you very much, Andreas. Got anything else for us, Matt?
Yes, Liam, I do have a question for us, and this one is for Alexander Johnson, and it is availability of module options for the whole degree. What about new incoming staff, PhD student teachers, etc.? How will they fit into this schedule?
Hey, sorry, Alex? Could you clarify that for me?
Matthew, could you please repeat the question?
Availability of module options for the whole degree. What about new incoming staff, PhD student teachers, etc.? How will they fit into this schedule?
Well, I certainly think we should take advantage of the skills that staff already have. New modules, they're definitely to be offered. In my course in particular, there was a massive gap left in the availability of modules left when someone retired. And seemingly not really been filled. There was maybe 6 options for my course, and that's not enough. And I know that's the story across campus for every student even. So yeah, I think new staff, they have new skills, and more specific staff and specialised staff should be approached when possible.
Okay, to follow up, how do you propose to bring new lecturers in, especially in those degrees where there currently isn't any choices whatsoever throughout the entire degree?
Well, I think that's really the obligation of the university to make this place an attractive place to work. So we need to be competitive, we need to offer lecturers something to make them want to work here.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex. So what else we got, Matthew?
I have here a question for Stuart Lidbetter, which is, when would you schedule December/January exams, and would you lobby for additional reading/writing weeks to create time for revision among the terms, other coursework that needs to be handed in before Christmas?
So my idea is to, I put December/January because ultimately I'm not sure what would be best for students right now. I might try and get them both, but as the university tends to close quite close to Christmas, it might not be available to do them in December. If not, they'll be done there in early January, probably alongside other essay deadlines that some degrees have, but not all of them. And I honestly think that you probably wouldn't need another reading week to do exams. I mean, normally I have one in week 12 anyway, so that's the last week I could revise for exams or stuff like that. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. Anything else, Matt?
Yes, this one is for Andreas Payne, and it is, How would you ensure that flexibility of assessments could be increased for all students, no matter their degree? Don't you think some degrees favour coursework over exams and vice versa? How could you keep this fair for all students?
I think the answer to that is the current system is about as far from fair as possible. There will always be some subjects that are more exam-based. There will always be some subjects that are more coursework-based. That is the nature of the subject. I mean, I think that needs to be made more clear to students when they're initially applying to their subject. What I want is, within those subjects, there to be some greater degree of flexibility. To give an example, in the School of Politics at the moment, short-term students have the option to do an extra essay instead of an exam. For someone like me that actually quite struggles with exams but does well at coursework, I'd like that option to be available to me also. That's just one example in my school. It has to be looked at on a school-by-school basis because, as I said earlier, there is a discrepancy and that discrepancy will always exist. It's about just getting that level of fairness better than what it is now, because at the moment the current system just isn't working as well as it should. Thank you.
Okay, just to follow up, it's a very interesting point you raise. How would you propose to make sure that your system works well? Because a lot of universities, when you apply, they make that clear whether they're more coursework-based or exam-based, especially when it comes to degrees such as science, even essay-based subjects. They specify what region or of history they do, for example. So how do you propose that you're going to give that flexibility without compromising the integrity of the degrees themselves?
The integrity of the degree, you are right, has to remain vital. However, when picking your module, so when I come to pick mine, it will often just sort of say 50% coursework, 50% exam. But then when you turn up on the first day, and as I said earlier, this availability for short-term students, it seems like, well, hang on a minute, why weren't these options available to me? Shouldn't I have had that? It is going to require a lot of work, a lot of thought. It's not something that's going to be done easily first day in office if you elect me. It will be a long-term process, but one that I think will be worth it for students. Everyone learns differently at the end of the day. Everyone performs differently. There's that age-old maxim, if you judge a fish and a monkey by its ability to climb a tree, the monkey will always win. It's a bit of a cliche, I know. However, I think it demonstrates my point well. I just want there to be that increased flexibility. It will be a long term, it will involve a lot of negotiation. Going back to one of the earlier questions, will require good relationships with members of staff to be built. But I think it's achievable and I think it will be beneficial for students.
Thank you very much. Okay, Matt, have we got anything for the other two candidates?
Yes, we have something for Alexander Johnson, and that is, which strategy would you suggest to avoid people being forced out of modules due to timetable clashes?
Well, I think having a realistic window of when that module would be placed within the week would be best. So if you had an idea of when this particular module would be taking place within the week, you'd be able to plan which choices you make accordingly. Of course, sometimes there's no actual choice, so that also needs to be worked on. I also think that where clashes are occurring, there needs to be more dialogue between different schools so they can switch rooms and make it more open for everyone.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex. Can we get a question for Dave at all, Matthew?
Here is a question for Dave, and it is, how useful is the Templeman open 24/7 in the first few weeks of term? Could you elaborate on the three strikes procedure you mean to put in place instead of library fines?
Okay, so two parts to this question. Let me address the first part first of all. So not everyone who studies at university comes here in September and finishes in June. Some people stay over summer because they're postgraduates, dissertations, PhD students and so much more. People want to learn when they choose to, basically. Having a 24/7 library throughout the year makes sense because some people study at different times of the year. That, for me, is my aim for that, is that to ensure that all students can study when they want. So I think it is going to be useful in the first weeks of term. Secondly, your point regarding... forgive me, I've forgotten the second part of the question. My brain's gone.
Matt, can we quickly repeat the second part of the question, please?
The previous question. That's the... Could you elaborate on the three strikes procedure you mean to put in place instead of library fines?
Okay.
Yeah, sorry about that. It's been a very long day. I'm very tired. Forgive me. Three strike procedures. So library fines for me are a bit of an outdated model in the current system.
10 seconds. Warning.
So 50p per hour is a ridiculously high number. I want to introduce a bit of a leeway for students who may have childcare
issues. I'm sorry,
issues.
I've got to cut you off. I'm afraid, Dave.
Seymour Manifesto.
Okay. So I believe now it's probably fair time that we actually go for a group question. So a substantial amount of postgraduate students do not have access to a physical library or any study space due to them studying at one of the European study centres. How do you support these students in these satellite campuses, as one of you called them? Stuart.
Ultimately, I think there needs to be more online resources for everyone to have access to. I understand online resources cost money, but if we invest in them, they remain for a very long time. They remain forever, I assume. So the students will be able to access them for years and years, and as students come and go, they'll still be able to access them.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. Alex?
Right, yeah, online resources, that's a good idea. Yeah, I agree. Postgraduate students, they definitely need a space, and I also think maybe an opportunity where they can meet staff all at once. So every postgraduate student doing a particular course comes in and has a group meeting, not like a seminar, and sort of across between a seminar and an open office hour.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex. Okay, Dave, you're next.
Could you repeat the question one more time, please?
The question is, a substantial amount of postgraduate students do not have access to a physical library or any study space whatsoever due to them studying at one of the European study centres. How would you support these students?
Yeah, so this ties into one of my manifesto points, which is about lecture recordings. So for me, having resources all online, like both candidates have said so far, is really important. For me, part of the thing that has been happening recently is the hidden course cost report, and ensuring that no student has to buy a book or, you know, they have to go to a library to find it. It should be available online if it's part of your course. As someone in the School of Arts, all of my readings are available on Moodle. They're only my lecturers physically put them up there. So I think that's something that should be rolled out across all schools. An issue with postgraduates I'd like to raise, which probably might tie into study space in particular, is the fact that I had a lecturer last term, Maria her name was, she was doing a PhD here, 54 years old, an amazing age to do a PhD, but she was kicked out of her office because the university wanted to renovate it, so she had nowhere to study. And I think that's wrong. Postgraduates need more study space.
10 seconds.
Whether it's in rooms or offices, that's something that I need to work with the KGSA to implement for all postgrads.
Thank you very much, Dave. Just to follow up, you talk about providing these ebooks aside the lecture recordings. How do you plan to fund this, considering ebooks are arguably as expensive, if not more expensive, than the academic materials hard copy?
Yeah, so what I mean here is lecturers scanning copies of books that they already have available in the library and uploading those to Moodle. It's done under an agreement called the CLA. Most of it's done free of charge. If it's not, universities should cover those costs. It's not a high amount to get a copyright license. So there isn't really a cost attached to it. It's already done by the lecturers in my school. It should be something that's applied to all schools.
Okay, thank you very much, Dave. Andreas, your turn.
Thank you. I don't want to add anything onto the e-resources argument. I think that's been made very eloquently by my three colleagues here. But the crux of the centre is the study centres in overseas. So, for example, in Brussels, it's a very small study centre. I know they don't have a huge amount of space there. Something like the Canterbury City Study Hub that I propose here at Canterbury, if that model works, there's no reason why that model can't be implemented in Brussels, in Paris, in Athens, where we have these study centres. In Tunbridge, which obviously isn't in Europe, just down the road. But I think that's one way we can look at it. E-resources, yes, are wonderful, but it has to be a longer-term goal there. And I think that could be started, modelled here at Canterbury, and then exported out. The other thing I'd say is making sure that the services they already have are up to scratch with the Canterbury campus. Even at Medway, they're struggling to access the same resources we have. So they need to all be brought up to scratch.
Okay, thank you very much. Just to follow up once again, you say that you want to trial this study space within Canterbury. How do you propose to fund this, especially when you're concerned about all of the other satellite campuses being underfunded, you know, not looked at well enough? Do you feel that it's worth funding the Canterbury campus? And then, if so, how do you propose to do that?
I think it's vital to fund the Canterbury campus. The Canterbury campus is the heart of the University of Kent. A lot of our research comes out of here, and that is what brings in a lot of our revenue, which we can then send to those other satellite campuses. In terms of funding, I sort of answered this in a previous question. The actual funding of a Canterbury City Study Hub would be a complex issue. It's something the university would have to get involved with. It's something I would like to think the council would be willing to put money into as well. Council is always looking for new ways to engage with the local community, further their own educational plans, and things like that. I think it's something that the council could look into as well, and it's something, as your Vice President of Education, I would certainly lobby for, so the entire burden of this isn't put on our university, but is shared across all those that would be able to benefit from it.
Thank you very much, Andreas. So, Matthew, what have you got for us?
I have a question here for Alexander Johnson, and that is, would the comprehensive coursework submission time be the same across all departments and schools? Is the Turnitin software geared for handling that much traffic at the same time, seeing that it slows down at peak times already, even though deadlines are spaced out?
No, this isn't for everyone. I think it's specific to each course. So if you took politics, you'd be prepared to have every single one of your essays due on, say, Friday at 11. Obviously, that's not what I'm committing to. This is all subject to whatever needs each student has or each specific course has, also considering lecturers when they're available and such. I'm not completely sure about Turnitin's ruggedness, but I'm sure it'll be able to handle it with a little bit of tweaking.
Okay, thank you very much, Alexander. So how do you propose to prioritise the different courses?
There's no real priority with courses. It's just... Sorry, what? No, but the fact that you can... There's no priority for courses. It's every course has a specific...
It's just that you stated from your answer that you wish to... give certain courses time slots. So how would you prioritise a specific course over another if they wanted the same time slot? How would you decide as VP Education?
Right. I'm not really sure it's my choice. I think they all need to talk to each other. Obviously, they might all want to do Friday at 11 or Sunday at 11, as is already common, but perhaps times throughout the day would also be necessary.
Okay. Thank you very much, Alex. Okay, got any more questions for us, Matt?
Here I have one for Dave Kokoza, which is, what's your views on how the university and union are currently funding education aids for the disabled and those with health issues?
So how the university is currently funding it? Well, a couple of things here. So the university has an access agreement, so it has scholarships for students that come through particular needs. So for myself, from a poorer background, however, because of my postcode, I wasn't allowed to get the bursary, which I think is a bit of a disgrace, really. But for disabled students in particular, I'm registered as disabled with my mental health condition, and I receive DSA funding. This is something that goes through the government. However, from what I understand, it's being cut, and I need to lobby the university to ensure that the money is still going to be there. If this goes through and DSA is cut, it's going to affect so many students, and accessibility to education for everyone is going to have a real hitting. And as VP Education, it's my job to lobby the university to ensure that money is there as available to every student who needs to have the extra funding to ensure they can complete their studies as well as everyone else.
Okay, thank you very much, Dave. You said that the cutting of the DSA will affect many, many students. How do you think it's going to affect those students? I mean, we don't even know if these cuts are guaranteed yet. What are you going to do about it?
Yes, so I mean, DSA provides a lifeline to many students who have the need to have adaptations to their learning. For example, my other half has a chair that she needs. She has computer equipment from the DSA. She has so many things that support her. Myself, I've had mentoring sessions paid for by the university with a counsellor. Not a city counsellor, but a sort of psychiatric counsellor. You know, I worry about the fact that they're going to be cut, and I really hope they aren't, but, you know, it's going to affect people in so many different ways. It's impossible to say what one student has and what other students don't, and what one student needs is completely different from the other one. And it's important for me to ensure that education is accessible to everyone. So in the role of VP Education, I would lobby university to make sure that what's currently offered will continue to be offered, if not in addition to other services. Like I say in my manifesto, there's points about mental health in there and support for all students via IOPs. Please read up on it if this is whoever sent this in. I'm sure you'll find information in the manifesto.
Thank you very much, Dave. Okay, what else you've got for us, Matt?
Here we have a question from Stuart Lidbetter, or for Stuart Lidbetter even, which is, could you elaborate on the idea of introducing new types of internal internet assessments? What about students with no social media accounts? Is there going to be training so everyone has the chance to try out these new assessments?
So I actually spoke with my head of department about this literally earlier today. Can you repeat the question?
Can we please repeat the question, Matt?
Sure, Stuart. The question is, could you elaborate on the idea of introducing new types of internet assessments? What about students with no social media accounts? Is there going to be training so everyone has the chance to try out these new assessments?
I'm going to try and institute training. I think the students will need to get these social media accounts because they're going into the modern age. They need to be online to be relevant still in the employability market. So I think they will have to, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. But what about those who aren't very good with technology?
Like I said, I was intend to also give training, like the lecturers or the academics would train the students how to use these things, train them how to do it well, and then they would have an assessment on it later in the year. Not all of them are strictly social media, like blogs wouldn't strictly be social media, they would be blogs.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. What else we got, Matthew?
Here in social media, we have a question for Andreas Payne, which is, which services concretely would you like to see extended to the Drill Hall Library, with Drill Hall being a shared facility with the University of Greenwich and CCCU? How will you negotiate that if it offers the same services as Templeman?
Thank you, it's a great question. It is a complex issue with the Drill Hall. We share that campus with three other universities. However, when I was speaking to the Medway Student Committee President about some ideas for Medway, he brought this to my attention. It was something I wasn't actually aware of, and I'm really glad he did. How we negotiate, well, that is a key issue. I mean, we'll have to speak to the University of Greenwich and with Canterbury Christchurch, work out what facilities they have available to their students. If students at University of Kent Medway campus have a Kent login in exactly the same way as us, there's no reason why we can't differentiate and make sure that those Kent students have exactly the same services that they would have on the Canterbury campus, and they're not being discriminated against just because of the fact that their course is based at Medway and not here at Canterbury. Whilst it'd be lovely to help the students of Greenwich and Christchurch as well, that's not within the Kent Vice President Education remit, so I'd have to work on Kent students there.
Okay, thank you very much, Andreas. But you said that different students from different campuses have different levels of service, but surely the EduRoam system, which covers all three campuses, to my knowledge, provides that very service that you're talking about.
As far as I'm aware, EduRoam is merely a Wi-Fi network that it enables other students, just so I can go to the University of Leeds, log into the Wi-Fi. Doesn't get me access to their library services, for example. I'd need a Leeds login for that. If Kent students have a Kent login, there is no reason why they can't access the same services that they would be able to if they'd logged onto a computer here in Canterbury. I think that's absurd, and I think that needs to be changed.
Okay, thank you very much, Andreas. What else you got for us, Matt?
Here we have a question for Alexander Johnson, which is, how would you provide teacher training, internal or external? Will it be a requirement for new incoming staff, and how is it going to be organised?
Primarily, I think this is an issue that has to be dealt with internally. I think staff that are leaving this university for a variety of reasons should offer any information, any insight they have to newcoming staff. Postgraduate students, I think, need more training in particular. Of course, they do a wonderful job, but I think more senior members of staff from a variety of schools have lots of input that they can offer, advice and such.
Thank you very much, Alex. What else you got, Matt?
We have a question here for Andreas Payne, which is, course reps are elected in the courses each year. Everybody can nominate her or himself. Do you feel Medway students are unfairly misrepresented among course reps? How do you plan to increase the number of Medway students among course reps?
Engagement in Medway is a huge issue that doesn't just cover course reps. It covers these leadership elections, it covers part-time officer elections, it covers when they're electing their own Medway Student Association president. Getting more people involved in Medway, yes, it's essential. I think I would draw on my experiences as a college president and try and build that greater sense of one Medway identity as itself as a college, and then use that to promote engagement. In terms specific to course reps, there are a number of courses that are dedicated purely on the Medway campus anyway. However, getting those split level, so those split courses where some students are based at Medway, some are in Canterbury, yes, we do need to get more Medway students involved. But I think that's part of a larger picture, and one that I think as Vice President of Education, I'd be able to work with other SAB officers and build this greater college identity, greater university identity, and that will help promote engagement across the board.
Thank you very much, Andreas. What else we got, Matt?
We have a question here for Dave Kokosa. Wouldn't students exploit this free breakfast during exam seasons?
Without putting egg on my face and kind of promising the world here, no, I don't think they would. So the way it offers in Leeds is that students are allowed one free breakfast a day. You can't just keep going up and having five or six bacon baps. As much as, you know, look at the size of me, I'd love that, but it's not going to be something that's possible. All the crew are laughing now. You need to control it. So the way it works in Leeds, from what I understand, and forgive me, I haven't been there because, well, my studies are here in Canterbury. As VP Education, I need to do some fact-finding about this. But you basically get a token, you exchange that for breakfast, tea, coffee. Yeah, we can give out as much as is physically possible within the allowance of budget we can get from the university. But free breakfast, I think it needs to be something that's low cost, cheap and healthy for everyone, but have enough for a limited supply during the day over the course of the exam term time. So I don't think it's exploitable, but there needs to be a system to ensure it's controlled. You're right.
Thank you very much, Dave. Okay, Matt, we're going to go for one last round of questions. What have you got for us?
Right. This question is for the previous round, and it's for Stuart. And it is, do you believe that all degrees are equal?
I think, as we are paying the same amount of money per student, that all degrees should be equal. They should all be held to the same level of quality with each other. And I think anything other than that is just ridiculous. It needs to be that way. Obviously, some schools have more members than others. That doesn't mean the smaller schools shouldn't be listened to or should be ignored, or the bigger schools should be prioritised by the university. I understand the university is obviously trying to make large schools bigger by getting more students to get more money, but the smaller schools shouldn't be neglected for the sake of the bigger schools.
Okay, thank you very much. You say that you obviously believe that these degrees are not equal, should be equal, but do you not feel that the varying cost between different degrees, so for example, a chemistry degree, you obviously need a lot more than $9,000 per head in order to pay for all the chemicals, all the equipment, all of that, is worth just as much as a degree in history, for example, in which you would just require a lot of books and the library services, as well as obviously the lecturers and stuff, which are for constants.
Could you repeat that? That was quite long. Sorry.
Sorry. Do you not feel that, even though you believe all degrees are equal, that by giving them all the same value, you're maybe diminishing degrees that may be more costly in themselves? So, for example, a chemistry degree where you require a lot of equipment in comparison to, say, history, which requires less.
While history, and I study ancient history, so I know, does require less things than chemistry, the university should be funding the additional cost per head for chemistry students because they would like to keep chemistry big and keep it good. I feel that a lot of the humanities students do not get anywhere near what they are paying, which I think is not fair at all, whereas I think a lot of sciences do tend to get much more of what they're paying, which is good, but I don't want to hamper the sciences, I want to bring other degrees up so they're getting more value for their money.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so this is our final round of questioning. So, Matthew, give us what you've got.
This is the final question for Dave, and this is, you talk about improving mental health services for students in your manifesto. Is this more relevant to VP welfare, and what will you do to change things?
Yes, of course, it's very relevant to VP welfare, and the reason I've put this in my manifesto is through my university life, I have struggled with my mental health so many times, and the support has never really been there. And if you've seen on my Facebook page, you'll see there's a video, and I'm not making this into a sob story to kind of win votes. I'm being just very honest and open about this, because there's so many things that are wrong with the systems, and there's stigma attached to mental health. I think we need to break that down. But in terms of what, yes, it is VP welfare, but it comes every student's welfare is important to every sabbatical officer. And for me in particular, with the mental health side of things, I was tossed between three different departments at this university. All of them sent me away. I saw my master, they didn't know what to do, they sent me away. I saw the advice centre, as much as I love it, they didn't know what to do, they sent me away. I ended up having a short hospital stay.
10 seconds.
This is wrong, it needs to change, and I want to work with the VP welfare to kind of mutually agree goals and make change for better for every student, so when they need these...
Sorry, I've got to cut you off now, Dave. Okay, what's next, Matt?
This next question is for Stuart Lidbetter, and it is, why do you think the current system of electing course and faculty reps needs to be reformed?
I don't believe it needs to be reformed. I just hear a lot of complaints from students saying that their course rep doesn't do a particularly good job, they don't attend meetings, and I hear also a lot of students complaining that they don't have a course rep, or it's empty, or they want to run. For example, in my first year, I wasn't even allowed to run as course rep for my degree because it was so new. So the first thing I did when I got to university is I had to go and fix that. So there obviously needs to be a little bit more quality control for course reps. My idea is just to keep the course rep elections open all year round, so there's always a chance to fill them. I'm thinking about trying to institute some sort of policy where you can review your course reps, but I'm not sure how feasible that is at the moment.
Okay, thank you very much. What's next, Matthew?
This next question is for Andreas Payne, and it is Free Wednesdays. This has been on the agenda for a long time. What do you think is the next and or final step to make it happen?
It's just more lobbying at the end of the day. Jack and Nina, as the two outgoing SABs for education and for sport, have done a super job so far. But it really is sort of fighting an uphill battle, and it's just, at the end of the day, it takes a lot more lobbying, keep the pressure up. Things like Walkout Wednesday that happened recently, issues like that, getting to talk to the sports teams, getting them involved, it has to be a joint effort between VP Sports and VP Education, a united front to keep lobbying the university, showing that the students not just want this, but need this to actually help improve their educational experience here at Kent. That's the argument that needs to be made, and one I think I could make quite articulately.
Thank you very much, Andreas. So can we have our last question, please, Matthew?
Our last question is for Alexander Johnson, and it is, with the student feedback that is to be collected each year by the course reps, why do you think the report should be open online after it was collected so that students can add their feedback? Isn't it enough that it is collected by the course reps?
Well, it certainly should be, but I think that if a student has to read this report, they might think, you know, that's a really good idea, but I've also got something to add. So with it as an ongoing system, people will input more and hopefully we'll get a more cogent response from the student body.
Thank you very much, Alexander. So that concludes this round of questions. I'd like to thank the candidates for VP Education for being here and for answering all of our questions to the best of their ability. I'd also like to thank you guys at home for bringing us so many different questions. We will be back soon with the activity section of our talk. In order to get any questions through, once again, all you need to do is make sure that you fill in the form at kentunion.co.uk/leadership-elections. And also, you can use our Twitter, which once again, you use our Twitter handle, @Kent_TV, using the hashtag CQTActivities. Now, we're going to be back soon, so why don't you watch this clip of KTV's achievements and NASA submissions? Thank you very much.
We are proud individuals living for the city, but the flames couldn't go much higher. We find God and religions to paint us with salvation, but no one, no, nobody can give you the power that the right. And down the walls of a dream that cannot breathe in its harsh reality. Mass confusion, spoon-fed to the blind, serves now to define a cold society from which we'll rise.
Is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people, and so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines, you are not cattle, you are men. You, the people, have the power to make this life free.
If I were a manifesto, where would I be? Oh, I could check there. Yeah. Okay, checking. No. Where could these manifestos be? Oh, I know. Yeah, no, I'll go look for them. Yeah, you can look for manifestos, right? Yeah. But if I were a manifesto, where would I be? Okay. If I were a manifesto, where would I be? Oh, is that another poster? I don't know. Do people put manifestos on the posters? Looking, it's just a blank piece of paper, okay. Guess I'll just leave that for now. Oh gosh, where are I? Oh. Little sign, okay, is it in here? Do people put things on the sign? Okay, nope, there's a wet floor sign for a reason. I'm just gonna put you back. No one saw that. Could they be in a bike shed? Do you put manifestos in a bike shed? I'll just check. Oh, I found leaves. Is it manifesto leaves? No, okay, I guess I'll just keep looking. Maybe it's in this bin. Open. Ugh. Oh, no, definitely not in there. Oh, that smells disgusting. Okay, it's not in there. Definitely not in there. Is that under a bench, maybe? It could be under a bench, right? Oh, gum. Yeah, cool. Yep. Oh, no, that's disgusting. Why'd I do that? Oh, stupid idea. Maybe the seagull has a manifesto? Can seagulls run for candidates? Elections? That thing? No? Okay. Oh, he's coming back. Okay, run away. This is supposed to be a map. It's supposed to tell you directions. Why can't it tell me the directions of the manifestos? Why can't I find these manifestos anywhere?
Annie, you know where they are.
But I don't know where to look!
But you know where the manifestos are. Kent Union website. Just go to the Kent Union website. Kent Union website!
Cool! Yeah! No, I know where the manifestos are. Okay, just go on to Kent Union website. Okay, go on representation, leadership elections. Oh, silly me. Oh, cool. Information. Yeah. Oh, but nominations are closed, aren't they? Yeah, they're closed. Anyway, oh, quiz the candidates. Candidate question time. Candidate manifesto launch. Ooh, click on that. Ah, cool. And all I need to do is click on each person. They have everything here. Ah, that's awesome. All I need to do is read them now. Nice. Well, it's a good thing I didn't stress about that one.
Yeah, and so, like, clubs, they're just not my thing.
Yeah.
I don't know what to do with my arms. It's like,
yeah, because you're always bouncing around like that.
I can handle a bar, though. A bar or a pub I can handle because I can talk to people. Yes. And talk, like, approach people.
Yes.
But a club, there's just not the same atmosphere.
I know. Oh, anyway.
What's going on with you?
Well, I've been really busy. I've had lots of work done, you know, but now that's over the way. And I thought, well, what can I do in my spare time? So I thought, hey, why not sign up to be a sabbatical officer?
A SABS officer?
Yeah.
A Kent Union?
Yeah.
Well, what are you thinking of going for?
Well, I thought my first one would be education, VP for education.
The Vice President for Education is the Kent Union officer in charge for academic presentation and educational campaigning. The officer sits on the Learning and Teaching Board as well as the Senate and other academic committees where they represent students and are right to the best education possible. VP Education is also the supporter of course, faculty and school reps.
VP Education?
Yeah.
I don't know, I can't really see you doing that. I was thinking maybe like activities because you do all like the student media stuff.
Yeah, that's true.
Like VP Activities?
Yeah.
The Vice President for Activities is the Kent Union officer responsible for all societies and extracurricular activities which are not covered by the Vice President for Sports, supporting and empowering all the volunteers who run and take part in these activities. In addition to this, VP Activities is the Director of Canterbury Youth Student Media, which runs CSRFM and has a close connection to student media.
What do you think of that?
I think it's good, but I thought, you know what? I might go into sports. VP Sports?
The Vice President for Sports is the Kent Union officer who campaigns for the development, promotion and defence of wide range sports and physical activities on offer here at the university. They work closely alongside the sports department to improve facilities and make them more accessible for students so that we all have the opportunity to improve our well-being. It is the VP Sports who works with those who run Kent Union sports clubs and along with Christchurch for annual sporting events.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I mean, come on, look at me.
I am. That's why I'm so disgusted. No, mate. VP Welfare.
Welfare?
Welfare.
The Vice President for Welfare is the Kent Union officer responsible for the defence and improvement of the welfare of students here at the University of Kent. VP Welfare works alongside university departments and has a seat in university committees to make sure that the university meets our needs while we study here. The Vice President for Welfare also is in charge of supporting Kent Union Student Committee welfare officers.
Do you think?
I don't know. I don't know if that's not sort of my forte, my cup of tea, if you will. So I thought, you know what, I'll bring out the big guns. I'm going to go for President.
No. Union President?
Union President. I mean, think about it, my name out in the lights. Star Union President.
The Union President leads Kent Union in improving the university for every student here at the University of Kent. The President is the ambassador for the Union and represents it with the University Administration, Canterbury City Council and local members of Parliament, among others. The President is a member of the University Council, the Senate, the Finance and Resources Committee and is the Chair of the Board of Trustees, being responsible for overseeing performance management of Kent Union's Chief Executive.
Well, bad news. It's kind of too late.
What?
Like, people have put in applications.
Better luck next year, mate.
I wish I had a way of changing what happens at my university. I'd stick a coffee machine right there. I'd probably make things a bit more wheelchair friendly. I'd definitely make beer free at Essentials.
Okay, maybe it's a good idea that I don't get a say in every single aspect of student life, but just like every other student, I do get a say by voting for different candidates in different union roles. To do that, all you gotta do is go down to the venue.
It's easy to get to venue, even from Rutherford. You've just gotta go... It's a venue. Alternatively, you can go to kentunion.co.uk/leadership-elections and vote online. Just click the Vote Now button, log in with your student account, and follow the instructions. You can read the candidates' manifestos and then vote for your nominations in the order that you want them.
Science guide us back.
dripping down the walls of a dream that cannot breathe in its harsh reality. Mass confusion, spoon-fed to the blind, served now to define a cold society from which we'll rise. No.
Despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men, with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines, you are not cattle, you are men. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful, to make this life a wonderful adventure.
Hi, I'm Alexander Lilly.
Hi, my name is Bridget.
The American Football Society, also known as the Kent Falcons.
The KFL Sports Society.
Fun.
and welcome to KTV's update of Varsity. My name's Mandy Corbambra.
And I'm Ali Golnick.
I'm George Stiles.
And I'm Ethan Bott.
I am Matthew Pepper.
And I'm Emma Borough.
I'm Kathy Farbridge.
And I'm Maisie Gosling.
Provided that forever is between the 13th and the 17th of February.
Thank you for watching this Kate with Varsity Update.
Good night, see you next year.
And welcome back! We hope you enjoyed our short intermission. I thought many of the clips were quite fun myself. This time we now have the VP Activities candidates waiting for their beautiful or horrible questions, depending on your personal opinion. So once again, I'm just going to go through, if you want to ask a question yourself, there are two ways you can do this. First off is going through the Kent Union website, kentunion.co.uk/leadership-elections, or you can use your Twitter account by sending the question directed either to one of the candidates with their name or to no one, in which case we'll ask the entire group, to @Kent_TV, and make sure that you use the hashtag CQTActivities so we know that it's for them. So, Matthew, how are you holding up? You know, we're halfway through, so yeah.
Me and the social media team here are enjoying the present proceedings. We would like to congratulate the candidates for the previous one for how well they performed. And we'd also like to thank the people at home for sending in the Twitter feeds, which we are enjoying reading and processing. Back to you, Liam.
Thank you. I would also like to second that thank you, because without you guys and your questions, this wouldn't be possible. So first off, we're going to do the speeches. Here are the rules for the speeches. Sorry, my apologies. My apologies, I'm jumping ahead of myself. I keep forgetting, yeah. So, the question is really, what does VP Activities really do?
Thank you very much for coming on to see us, Tom.
It's all right.
So, you've been VP Activities for 2 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give us an overview of what the VP for Activities is responsible for? What do you do?
So, the VP Activities is responsible for everything extracurricular barring sport. So that's all of our societies, which I believe we have around 140 of, all of our volunteering societies, RAG, which is Raise and Give, our fundraising society, Student Media, which covers KTV, Inquire and CSR, and then also the VP Activities is also involved in Kent Tech and also volunteering as well. So that's kind of the remit of VP Activities, so nothing too large.
Nothing too daunting.
No.
So, of all your responsibilities,
mm-hmm.
what's your favourite thing to be doing?
I enjoy all of it really. It's all very different in a way. I mean, I think just when you think you've learned everything and nothing can surprise you, something always comes along to surprise you. But I think they're all so different in their own ways. I mean, like, the fundraising is really interesting. I was never really involved in the charity sector before I got involved with the Students' Union. I never really knew a lot about fundraising, so that was amazing to think just how much money is raised and how much you can actually raise just standing outside of Centrals with a bucket, for example. I mean, Student Media, I think just the level of the quality of entertainment that comes out of Student Media. I think sometimes when you come involved in universities, the perception is often that it's often just like two people and a video and a smartphone video camera filming something, and then you go to one of the KTV screenings and what you see is, yeah, it's quite incredible. It's like, really is like, wow, I did not realise that they were that good.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries, you guys deserve it. I mean, your work is fantastic, it really is. And I think for societies, well, I mean, what can you say about societies? They literally cover everything there is to cover when you've got Kent Animated to Real Ale Society, right up to Kent Conservative Society, right up to the Fashion Society. Literally anything you could possibly think of, there is a society for it. Which, although on the one hand is incredibly interesting and fascinating, also makes it incredibly daunting and challenging to manage, particularly when you have very conflicting societies, such as, say, the Vegetarian Society and the Hunting Society, or many others. Or, say, the Are You Not Drinking Much Society and the Real Ale Society, for example. So there's lots of balances in that.
Okay, so how was your campaigning fortnight? How did campaigning for elections go for you? Both times.
Well, I'm still here, so actually it must have gone fairly well. I suppose, what do you mean, like in like what I got up to?
Was it a very stressful week?
I think it is stressful. I suppose it's how you handle it and how prepared you are for it. I was quite prepared for it, both I suppose like physically having banners and materials and like mentally prepared for it. I kind of psyched myself up for it, so to speak. So I didn't find it too stressful, but it is a very stressful week. However, it's a very good week as well. It's a fantastic experience and you realise so much about yourself. I mean, I suppose election week really is a very like rare time in your life when you can really look within yourself and get an idea of just how much you can take, both physically during the campaign trail, emotionally with what happens during, say, the election hustings, the various incidents that we know that happen during election week, and I suppose also like how much you can achieve when you get to the results night and you see all those people that have voted for you and believe in you, which I suppose that's a bit biased coming from personally one, but that is really a fantastic feeling that many people believed in you. And even for those people that are not lucky enough to win, they still have all the experience they've learned and also all that material they can then use for future job interviews, etc. So I think it's very rare for someone to leave the election week, even for those who don't win, and come out and say, I regretted going into it. Most people I speak to, they all enjoyed the experience and they would have done it again, even if they'd had to lose a second time.
So, do you have any advice for the current candidates for your position?
I'd probably say you need to be a good multitasker. It's certainly a role that you can't focus on just one thing. You have to focus on 10 different things and then have another 10 things in the background going on. So that was something I struggled with. I'm not a very good multitasker, as I've since learned to doing the role. So that is something I'd advise. I suppose, don't take it too seriously. I mean, I suppose it's a lot, you could look at that and think, of course you need to take it seriously, you're responsible for a £10 million organisation, but if you take it too seriously, you almost get sucked into your own bubble, and then don't build those relationships, don't invest that time into other groups, which of course becomes hugely important to your role. And I suppose the third thing is just to enjoy it. I mean, it is a once in a lifetime experience. You're not going to get many like it. And while sometimes the role may be really, really crummy, and you may feel like it's all just going, falling apart around you, it is a fantastic experience. You learn so much about yourself, and you can make a difference in the role.
Fantastic. So, finally, what do you think is going to be the hottest topic for elections this year? What's going to be the big issue that everyone needs to focus on?
In regards to just the activities role or the entire thing?
If you've got something for the entire thing, that'll be great.
Okay,
but activities, what do you think the area in activities, what's the next step?
I think the hot buttons and activities are, Free Wednesdays has always been a big one. Traditionally more for sports, however I know it does affect societies. Particularly, I suppose, I know Student Media and RAG, they have, it comes up quite a lot there. I suppose free activities, that's quite a hot button at the moment, particularly a lot of students feeling that given how much they pay in tuition fees, they should get their extracurricular for free and not have to pay extra for it. The problem that VP activities will need to balance with is how they balance that compared to, say, the low cost of joining a society and the high cost of joining a sports club. If you look at Essex, for example, they have free activities, but what that's done is it's caused a huge increase in sport membership that's decreased society membership and also decreased membership for other extracurricular activities as well. So I suppose a VP activity is the case of how to balance both keeping it free but also ensuring that people are still engaged in societies and that you don't have a situation where one part of the extracurricular just completely dominates and the others are left by the wayside. With regards to the entire election as a whole, I suppose it's just a case of this is, we're moving into a real big period of change with regards to higher education is moving into a more, like, I suppose, it's moving into like its official recession, so to speak. So universities are much less inclined to fund things. They're much more inclined to cut back on savings. Politically, it's a really interesting time when you've got the likes of Jeremy Corbyn, Donald Trump, Bernie Sanders. I mean, everyone seems to be almost throwing out their old political system and bringing in a new system. So what that means for political unions, sorry, not political unions, student unions, I don't know. And yeah, so I suppose for those coming in, this could be a real big period of change, whether that's good change or bad change, I suppose, we'll find out over the next few years, and I suppose it's up to them to, survive that.
So, we're just about done. Do you have any closing remarks for us?
In what way?
So, like, do you want to wish the candidates luck or give any lasting bits of advice just to end the video with?
Yeah, sure.
I know that was really vague.
No, that's fine. I actually don't think. I suppose I'd like to say good luck to all the candidates. As I said, it's a fantastic week. You're enjoying the experience. Keep it clean. I mean, no one likes a dirty election. They're the worst kind. You only need to look at Donald Trump in America for that kind of thing. Let's keep it clean. Have a good time, and yeah, even if you don't win, there are always bigger and better things you can always move into. With one door closes, one door opens. And as I say, good luck and enjoy.
So now you've seen what the VP of Activities does. Now let's take a look at our candidates and see what they want to do with their term.
I'm Jasper Gogol-Sicklin. I'm running to be Vice President of Activities. I want to empower international students, enhance the forums, inspire excellent departments. Hashtag MyJASP.
I'm Sam Marshall. I'm running for VP at Activities. For a more rewarding union, increased society discounts and a ball, vote Sam because only Sam can.
Okay. Hi, I'm Ruth. Rely on me to bring you free memberships for your societies funded by the university, dedicated space for your societies and online banking. So rely on Ruth.
Okay, so now you've gotten to grips a little bit with the candidates, so now it's time for their speeches. So here's the rules, guys. You've got 2 minutes for your speech. I will give you a visual warning by raising my cards like so. That will be your 30-second warning. You will get a verbal warning of 10 seconds, and if you go over 2 minutes, I will cut you off. Okay? Jasper, you're to start.
Empower, enhance, and inspire. Three objectives and a strong focus. I am Jasper Gogol-Sicklin, an American Studies student. I'm standing to be your VP Activities. As we know, empowerment. International students do not dedicate their enough time to activities. We have a huge amount of language on offer, from European to Mandarin to Cantonese. I want to bring this together. From my past experience in Canada at Brock University, I want to create a conversation partner program, a program dedicated on bringing these language skills and uniting the cultures and through cultural networking. I'll expand upon this and work with the new VP Welfare. This will be followed by a cultural and volunteering review and expanding the society executive. Secondly, enhance. The forum system is broken. I am the only candidate which has stated this in their manifesto. The forums are disattached, with low membership, and each forum rep is given £200, which no view or no focus is on. This is why I want to establish a Forum of the Year scheme. A scheme which will work like the Harry Potter House Cup, bringing loyalty and gaining points through society events and through merit and awards. I want to forge competition and loyalty and bring a cohesive nature. I'll also reform the toolkit, uniting our volunteers who are impressive and dedicated in their own right. Thirdly, inspire. Our time at university is different now. Research is suggesting that degrees are no longer important. It is a piece of paper which shows no reflection of experience or personality. Degrees are no longer a must for these employers, and students have to search for avenues to compete against other students and work with merit and for their own achievements. Therefore, I want to inspire how extracurricular activities are viewed. Our participation shows passion, dedication, and it shows that we break barriers together, uniting on extracurricular. I want to establish the four foundations of this change, reforming the room booking system and working with employability points and external departments. The union has its faults. The unions outside of it fail to grasp its beautiful and potential. I want to fix this through my strong focus. I owe the union a lot and I want to bring back. Show that it can be the catalyst for growth in your life, like it was for me.
I've got to cut you off, sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. Michael, can you please take the podium? Your time starts when you start speaking.
Hi. I'm Michael Thompson, and I'm running for VP of Activities. It's an amazing position with the power to affect many students on campus. From societies to volunteering, student media to community outreach, the VP of Activities is the front line for organising all of these programs. My goal is simple. Take what works, fix what doesn't work perfectly, and add more options. I'm currently the president of WCS, and I have held other roles before, and during my time I faced many issues with running of a society. If elected, I intend to make the running of societies easier. Improving room bookings to make it more open and allow for last minute room bookings. Improved committee elections, since the current system that's just been in place this year is rather restricting, and surely having more options open would be the benefit of everyone. Improving the way students are rewarded for volunteering is also important. Toolkits and KSCV have been criticised in the past, but the amount of students who don't even know that these systems exist is really unfortunate. Also, funding is really important, and I think I'll be thinking about this if I was elected. Last year, 53 societies applied for the development fund, but less than half, 20, received any funding, and some of those didn't receive all of what they asked for. Also, the price of first aid training is out of the budget for many smaller societies who would find it crippling to pay £20 per committee member. To close off, I'm open to suggestions, and I want to try and make the running of activities and everything that's currently working so far better, rather than adding new ideas and just decreasing the budget for that's currently available. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Ruth, it's your turn to take up the podium.
Hi, I'm Ruth Wilkinson, and I'm running to be your VP Activities. I've been involved with Kent Union since my first year, joining a range of societies and clubs like the orchestra, Kent Dance, yoga, and sailing. Extracurricular activities have been such a huge part of my university life, and I'm passionate about making change and improving this for students, which is why last year I chose to leave my job working for Kent Union in the Library Cafe and run in the election to become a student trustee, a role which involves sitting on the board of trustees for the union. Being part of both a sports team and a society, I'm aware that there's a lot of support and promotion offered to sports clubs that should also be offered to societies. That's what inspired my manifesto point, We Are Kent. It's about the fact that societies represent Kent too, and they should have the same access to organised club photos, University of Kent colours and branded kit, and an end-of-year celebration event to reward them. I also want to implement something called Society Spotlight. This is where societies will have access to the official Kent Union social networks and websites to advertise and promote their club. Another huge issue that societies face is finding space to do their activities. I will lobby the university to make sure that they are intending to provide more flat floor and dedicated space for activities. In my year on the board, I've been involved in the architectural designs for building a new dance studio in the Woody's development space, so I know this will be possible to achieve. Finally, I want the university to recognise that extracurricular activity is such activities by funding them themselves, so that students no longer have to pay for memberships. This has already been done at the University of Essex, so it is entirely feasible and means that students can get involved no matter the cost. Thank you so much for listening, and thanks also to all the KTV volunteers who are giving us this platform.
Thank you very much. Okay, Sam, it's your turn to take the podium.
Hi, Hi, I'm Sam Marshall and I'm running for VP Activities. I'm running because I have a sincere and genuine passion to improve the system for all students who participate in activities. I'm the founder and president of BioSoc, and in our 2 years so far, we've held many successful events, such as Canine Cuddles with the Dogs Trust and our trip to Portlaoise Animal Reserve at the start of the year. These have increased our membership to 115 members in just a year and a half. This year, I also sat on the Society's Executive Committee, known as SOC Exec, as Elections Officer. My time on SOC Exec has really highlighted the issues that societies face and the different ways that each society works. And working alongside current VP Tom Curry has really given me an insight into what the position entails. I definitely feel that experience on the Society's Executive is essential for anyone running for VP activities. My Resurrect a Society campaign provided a platform for students to approach me and be assisted in their efforts, with 14 societies now reinstated. If elected VP activities, I would be doing the same thing on a larger platform. I wrote my manifesto based on my own experience and feedback I've received from other societies, through personal contact or through the SOC Exec. There are several issues that need addressing, but I'm not going to talk about my idea for a late night Medway bus, and I'm not going to talk about getting cheaper kit and promotional materials for societies. Instead, I want to draw attention to the work I want to do on how little the university recognises the efforts of all student volunteers on both campuses, whether RAG, student media and societies. This would increase graduate employability and your chances to get a job. If elected, I will improve activities for all students. I will do this through better engagement with the university and the union to provide more funds for recognition and rewards. I will also provide a better platform for feedback for current and future committees, resulting in a more collaborative and communicative student union. So vote Sam number one for VP activities, because only Sam can.
Thank you very much, Sam. Okay. So now that you've had a little chance to hear about the candidates, it's now time to start asking the questions. The easy ones, the hard ones, and everything in between. So we're going to start off with you, Jasper. And your question is, and this is going to be for the entire group, may I add, what makes you a suitable candidate for VP activities?
I'm suitable because of my past experience. I've been the treasurer of the Kent Debating Society and organised the funds. I also received sponsorship from the Kent Law School of £500. I've worked with societies and the society executive, organising networking nights, international showcase, and organising my own forum. I've also received the Gold Plus of Kent Volunteering and shown that I am constantly trying and breaking my own personal barriers and constraints. I want to stand up for these activities and show that you can make a change and you're not isolating yourselves in your room, and that by participating in activities, you're really building upon yourself.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Michael?
Well, I'm the current president of the Western Cartoon Society, which is the smallest society in this special interest forum. And I feel that I'm trying to represent a lot of smaller societies who don't get a lot of budget and just really want like small changes that will improve them and benefit all societies around the world. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Michael. Ruth?
Okay, well, I'm the president of the Sailing and Windsurfing Club. I've been part of a lot of societies. I'm also a student trustee of Kent Union, which means I sit on the board and hear basically everything that goes on in Kent Union, which is actually what the board that also the sabbatical officers sit on. I've been very involved with Kent Union since I started here, working for Kent Union, so I feel like I've got a really broad range of experience to bring to this role.
Thank you very much, Ruth. And finally, Sam.
As a member of SOC Exec, I ran my own campaign, which was completely unique to SOC Exec. I feel that as a founder of a society, I've definitely experienced the issues that can be faced there, and I have a lot of drive and passion and enthusiasm to put into this role. The events that I've organised through BioSoc have shown that I have a wide range of abilities and things that I think could be improved upon. And as a sabbatical officer, although my focus will be activities, you are also required to work with the other sabbatical officers to improve the general student experience.
30 seconds. Thank you very much. Okay, so now for the second group question, and this will start once again with you, Sam. What would you do to support student media? Because obviously you understand that this entire operation is a very big one. So what would you do to support it?
From speaking to members of the student media, I think the thing that you want the most,
you value your independence, and I wouldn't ever want to try and interfere with that. What I would want to do is try and promote the use of you by other societies. A big part of my manifesto is encouraging collaboration between societies, and I think that society and student media could both benefit from events being broadcast more, from the Inquirer reporting on events more. So it would increase your exposure, it would increase your opportunities to actually report on things, and it would improve the union as a whole.
Thank you very much. Ruth?
So I actually think the stuff that KTV and Inquirer and CSR do at the moment, their original stuff, is so fantastic. What I would really like to do is improve that, the scope of that, so make sure that more people are watching it, make sure more people are engaging with it. So that means things like broadcasting it in Woodies, broadcasting it in Essentials, making sure it is showing on in other outlets, even if they're not Kent Union outlets. And I'd definitely be really behind trying to get you like a lot more members engaged, so that you can keep doing what you do, because I've seen a lot of the stuff that you guys get up to, and the creativity is fantastic, so I want to basically inspire that.
Thank you very much. Michael?
Well, Student Media here is a really creative and amazing organisation, and I feel that linking that in with societies and other volunteering organisations would really benefit both Student Media and societies, and like just simply like advertising events and like just straight up societies like that are new for this year would benefit everyone, and I feel this would, yeah.
Thank you very much, Michael. And finally, Jasper.
The student media here is so impressive with the amount of opportunities it offers to students, and it really is the foundations of their employability for whatever industry they would like to go in. I would like to expand upon this, work with external companies and work with larger companies, with KTV, so these students and your volunteers can go to these graduate schemes and show at assessment centres that here I am KTV, I've won awards and I worked really hard and showed my passion and dedication. And I want to try and build the toolkit up so that you log your volunteering hours on a weekly basis. Your committee meetings are scheduled so you don't have to worry about all the work you're doing, like during selections time. You're so impressive and I love you for that.
Thank you very much, Jasper. So for the next set of questions, these are going to be questions asked by real people via the Kent Union website and Twitter. Matthew is going to give them, and for these questions, you're going to only have 1 minute to answer them. You'll still get the 30-second visual warning with the raise of the cards and the 10-second verbal warning as well. Once again, I will cut you off if you run over. So Matthew, what questions have you collected for our candidates this time?
Liam, we have a variety of questions where I'll move over to our PyTech board, which I used last time, so we can commence with the candidate questions. The first one of which is for Jasper, and it is, how would you suggest to change the room booking system in regard to the timetabling office?
Now, the room booking system is vital. I've had numerous issues with it, and I know societies have had numerous issues with it. I would like to reform it by looking at the system and showing the staff that, well, here we are, and this is our activities. Royal Holloway has a system, which I've researched, and it uses a system online with data, and we can tell who has booked the room and for how long. I want to try and implement that and work with the union with that, and have a room booking system which is so cohesive, so we know where the schedules are, and we know which societies are using the rooms, and really lobby the university for this change.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Okay, Matthew, for another candidate, please.
Right, our next question is for Michael Thompson, and that is, you talk about wanting to extend the hours for room bookings. How do you intend on getting around the current timetabling issues?
Well, when I said I wanted to extend the current time for room bookings, what I meant was that I wanted to extend it to for late night bookings in order to... There are a lot of events that a lot of societies would like to do at late night steering rooms, and currently it's only booked up to 11, and even then, a lot of the time when you're having an event and it's running and CampusWatch will just come at 10 o'clock and tell you that you need to stop. So I really want to extend it to later times. I'd also want to improve room booking by simply just like allowing for late room bookings to allow people to, if a room that you would prefer to run in is empty at the time, and you can prove that it's empty that it's been empty for a while, I'd like to be able to book it there and then.
10 seconds.
And that's the kind of things I'd like to do to extend and improve the room booking system.
Thank you very much, Michael. Just wondering, you're talking about making these late room bookings later, start, you know, they're currently at 11, you want them later on. Do you not feel this might pose a certain security risk, especially with the amount of drinking on campus with students just on a daily night out?
I feel that it's important that societies have at least the option to have later room bookings. And yes, whilst it could pose a security risk, I feel that Campus Watch is an amazing team of people who run and help the security of campus. So I feel that they are definitely up to the task.
Thank you very much, Michael. So, Matthew, for another candidate, what you got?
You say that you want to be able to meet up with all societies every month. How do you think this will work in terms of timetabling?
Well, that would absolutely be a priority, because if I can't talk to the societies, I wouldn't be doing a very good job. So that would basically be, if a society or a committee member wanted to meet me, they could send me a message on Facebook, which I would obviously keep in touch with, and then we'd arrange a meeting, and I would absolutely be dedicated to keeping in touch, because there's no point in me spending the whole year working really hard for other stuff if I'm not actually engaging with the societies themselves.
Thank you, Ruth. Could you not argue, though, that the informality of your plan in order to keep in contact with the societies could cause a massive organisational issue, especially with your other responsibilities as VP activities within the union?
I mean, I think it's really important that I am relatable and connected with societies. It shouldn't be that you have to do a booking form or anything like that. I mean, it will be really important that, you know, that time is managed. Obviously, there may have to be some changes, and maybe, you know, I might not be able to make the one time that the society might be able to make. But no, I do think it is really important that I'm easily contacted and can have that personal relationship with all the societies.
Thank you very much, Ruth. Okay, Matthew, have you got any for our last candidate?
Question is for Sam Marshall, and it is, you talk about improving the KSCV system to allow returning volunteers to retain the stages they've reached. If this is across university years, do you not think it's too easy to gain a volunteering certificate, as 200 hours across 3 years undermines the achievement of someone who achieves 200 hours in just 1 year?
Yeah, so what I meant with this was not to erase the stages, you would still have to redo those, but to eliminate the process in the first place. There's only so many times you can re-rate your skills, there's only so many times you can write a paragraph about what you've done for your gold review. There's only so many times you can do that. When you're logging all the same hours, you reach a certain point where you're just sat there and you're thinking, I don't know what else to write because I've written it all before. So when I say I want to improve the KSCV system, that is the kind of thing I'm talking about. I would also want to add in additional higher levels, because we do often exceed the levels that are already reached.
Thank you very much, Sam. But your claims are very general. Could you please specify on how specifically you would improve the KSCV system?
Well, I know that MSL are particularly difficult to work with, so without actually being in the position and knowing the details of it, I don't really know how specific I can go. But I would want to... I don't know which bit did you think was general?
Just the processes and limitations that you were talking about. How would you ensure that you retained the value of it while being more specific with your changes? So would you, for example, remove specific skills or remove specific sections?
No, you would need to go through that initially in the first place. But if you've done 2 years of volunteering already, you're in your third year, and then you're re-rating your skills for the Bronze Award, it does feel to you particularly demotivating and a bit demeaning, because you've done it all before. And improve on that. It wouldn't remove the initial setting, but shouldn't have to do it 4 times.
Okay. Thank you very much, Sam. Okay, Matthew, on to the next round of questions. What have you got for us?
Right, this next question is for Ruth Wilkinson, and it is relating to your manifesto point on meeting space. Is the folks room, a non-teaching room, new to this academic year, specifically dedicated for societies to use, not sufficient? Considering the folks room is underused as it is, why and where do you plan to source additional non-teaching rooms from?
So I think that this point is generally about space for societies. I talk a lot about flat floor space, and that is really important because there is a real lack of that, and actually really good flat floor space. But I think also the meeting rooms, I think you should be able to come up and use different kind of meeting rooms. I mean, it also needs to be more widely publicised, so societies need to know that they can book it. There needs to be an easily accessible booking form, and also they need to be able to have access to it at certain times. I know the folks room is really good and really useful, but it's a little bit out of the way, especially for people like RAG who want to go and count money. They have to lug the money all the way over there, so that's definitely something that I'd look into and consider.
Okay, thank you very much, Ruth. What else have we got then, Matthew?
This next question is for Michael Thompson, and it is, you mentioned that you would like to increase the overall turnout to societies and increase the amount they are advertised. How do you intend to do this? Could you expand on this?
Well, I intend to improve society advertising in a number of ways. Partially via just allowing societies to advertise themselves and events on the many TVs that are around in and around campus. There are TVs in Darwin, there are TVs in Keynes, there are everywhere. And many students just see them, and they are just prime opportunities for advertising for society. More outside billboards to allow to put flyers and just more generally more places to be able to say, my society is here, my society exists, and I'd like to show that my society is around.
Okay, thank you, Michael. However, you talk about making sure that the societies are well advertised through using the TVs. How do you propose to do this, considering around about 80%, I'd say, of the TVs are not Kent Union-owned? And how would you plan to fund that, considering they're from private companies or the university itself?
Well, I feel that Kent Union should be able to work with the university to allow for societies to advertise themselves on those TVs. I mean, those TVs are really important for advertising things that Kent as a university is doing, and societies are part of the university. So I feel lobbying towards the university to allow for societies to advertise themselves on those TVs would be a very important way of showing yourself.
But what about the private companies such as Kent Sport?
Unfortunately, I don't know much.
Okay, thank you very much, Michael. Okay, Matthew, any further questions?
Yes, we have another question for Sam Marshall, and this one is, can you explain your point about fast contact with companies for leaflets, posters, and clothing to societies to amend as they wish? Why would you not rather collaborate with the on-campus print and design centre instead?
I personally wouldn't want to deal with them because of the bad experiences that I have had with them as BioSoc president, and of the reports I've had from lots of other societies that have had bad experiences with them. The service has been late, poor quality, and they're rude on occasion. It also doesn't give much choice for colour of hoodies, t-shirts, and I've found in the past that whilst searching online for a better alternative, it can take hours and hours to do this. So while societies are welcome to do this, I find it would be much easier to have a company that I could say, we've worked with these before, they've got a discount for Kent students, and they give a fast turnaround. And I think it's just, I am aware that societies can use Rhino and can use the Kent Union branding, but I know that for a lot of them, these are rather expensive and societies would rather use a cheaper alternative.
Okay, thank you very much. You say that you had bad experiences with the printing service provided by the university. This, sounds like you're saying there's a bad relationship between society and university. How would you propose to improve that relationship to ensure that there's a good service coming from that printing service?
Well, I would propose that if any complaints are issued, which I know there have been this year, that they are actually followed through, because unfortunately that hasn't been the case. If I was elected sabbatical officer, I would ensure that any complaints, regardless of to which company, if there were issues that students were having, I would want to chase up on this. It shouldn't be the case that students are condescended upon or treated more poorly just because of our status. And I would definitely want to work with, if the Design and Print Centre wanted to work with the Kent Union to improve their image on campus, I would happily try and encourage that.
Thank you very much, Sam. So any other questions for Jasper, possibly, Matthew?
It's good you said that, because we have a Jasper question lined up for you now, and that is, you feel the volunteering toolkit is outdated. How do you propose reforming it into a weekly system? Can you give more details, please?
Well, the system is used by MSL at the moment, and if you look and compare it with the Welcome Week events, the Welcome Week events are scheduled so it logs your training on automatically and it logs your hours, so you don't have to do that. I would like to try and work with this and work with MSL to try and build that relationship, to try and make sure KSCV is actually achievable. Having barriers, and if you go over Gold Plus, and if you work through it through years, have vouchers for if you're logging a certain amount of volunteering a month, having these awards that you keep going, and it's not just a bit of paper like, oh yeah, I'm just going to put that on my CV now. No, I want to show students that here's the KSCV and here's what I can get from it, here's my merits and awards from it, and other students can participate as well.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Do you not feel that using vouchers kind of undermines the importance of the KSCV award as volunteering? It makes it sound like you're wanting to people to volunteer for a reward at the end, which in itself isn't volunteering.
Not really, but it gives that motivation for students. Like, students at the moment lack that motivation to volunteer because they feel like it's like a waste of time, the students I've spoken to. They don't want to get up because it's just like, I'm just wasting my time logging hours. Well, no, it's not. That you're putting your effort in. I know this is most of us who engage with Kenyon, that we love volunteering because of the amount of work that we do. But a lot of the students, they don't engage with the union. So that's why I'm proposing having vouchers, a voucher with essentials and vouchers with woodies, because this will spark the interest in students who are not involved in volunteering. I worked with students when I was out in Brock University. They didn't engage with the union, and this is how we need. We need to incentivise the experience and to work and improve the experience overall.
Thank you very much, Jasper. So, Matthew, we're on to another round. What questions have you got for our victims? I mean, candidates.
Right. This question is for Michael, and it is, why do you think that Enquire/KTV need a weekly newsletter?
Well, I feel that there are many students who just don't get access to Enquire and KTV. I wasn't even aware of the wonderful work that KTV was doing until after my first year. And I feel that having a weekly newsletter going through into your student emails would just give a great way for students to just find out what's on KTV, what's on in the Enquire, and yes, and even make them more likely to subscribe to the YouTube channel or pick up the newspaper and essentials in other places.
Thank you very much, Michael. Who do you propose is going to give out these newsletters to the entire student body? KTV, CSR, Enquire, the entirety of student media already provide newsletters to their members, which is already a large enough task as it is.
Well, I feel that If you're possible to send your KTV to the members, then it should be possible to send it to all students via the emailing system. Sending it to your members is a little bit self-serving in the sense that you should be able to try and send emails to all students and allow your news that you're reporting to be seen by everyone, and not just the people who are obviously going to be aware and want to see your news.
Thank you very much. Just to clarify, you were saying about how it would be relatively easy for us to give it out as an email to the entire student body. I think that for us that's an incredibly hard task because of security reasons. But anyways, we're going to move on to the next question.
Next question is for Jasper, and it is, you mentioned how the university can be resistant to change. Does this mean you think you will end up in conflict with the university if you try to enact your manifesto promises, assuming you are elected?
Yes, the university maintains its tradition, but what you have to do is you work from the bottom to the top. You work steadily to influence the university and work steadily with departments and schools to show that we make a difference. To show, here is the extracurricular that the Kent Debating Society, show that they worked with school children to have these debates and shows that they use their degree for a use outside of the normal classroom and essay-based. What I'm not going to have a conflict with the university because I've built relations with the schools. I have a high relationship with the employabilities at the point at the moment, and I want to found on that change further. The university has its traditions, but I want to keep working steadily at a time in order to bring reform.
Thank you very much, Jasper. With your approach of slow and steady, do you not feel that the tasks that you're going to be handed is going to be too large to deal with in a single term?
That's why we conduct a review. A review in the first term, and then steadily work out what areas to focus on. If the schools lack the employability section, we focus on that section to bring change to the university. I know with room bookings, we need that slow change. We can't be direct about it, because they'll be resistant and they won't go for our activities. We need to show this social media presence. Have maybe Snapchat and our social media and KTV show the university at this time. Like, bring them evidence, instead of just stating it randomly for a bit of fluff on a bit of paper. Like, show them the hard evidence that this is what we achieve, and that we can do it like without the university, and that we need them to have that cooperation and support.
Thank you very much, Jasper. So what questions have we got now, Matthew?
Right, now we have a question here for Sam Marshall, which is, how do you plan to help volunteering societies which need to actively sign people up to register and only get a yearly budget of £100 to do this?
That's a really interesting question, and there's several ways I'd go about this. I'd go about it with more promotion and more funding. So by promotion, I'm talking about using KTV again to broadcast events, to film it, for inquiry to report on it. For sign-ups, the most important thing is exposure. So I would also use social media, the Kent Union Society's page, which has 1,000 likes currently, posts are put out on that all the time. The weekly newsletters that go out as well. So all societies are welcome to send in their events, their stories, any successes they've had. I also would try and encourage volunteering societies to work with societies and sports clubs to join up events. So donations could be, for example, I've noticed UKC Belly Dance are doing a showcase in conjunction with Kent Marrow, and I think that's great. I would also want to try and apply for more funding for them, because £100 is ridiculous and the university should be giving more than that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sam. So with your response with trying to get KTV to cover all the societies, there's many, many societies. How do you propose that we, although we're passionate, limited number of volunteers are able to cover so many different societies?
Yeah, I'd appreciate that will be a big task for you, and obviously I'm not going to try and force you to do anything, but I do want to provide you with more opportunities. They could also look into funding for KTV, so a small stipend to film the events or report on them, and then that would increase your funding and also improve the exposure for the societies themselves.
Thank you very much. And back to you, Matthew.
Right, our next question comes in from Twitter from @SarahFreeman2, and this question is for Ruth, and it is, what would you do to make societies feel more valued at UKC?
Thanks, Sarah, for that question. I definitely think that societies need to feel more valued, so a couple of things that I want to do. The UKC, University of Kent, committee photos and team photos that all the sports clubs get, that should be available for societies too at the same time. You should be able to come down and have a proper photo in front of Canterbury Cathedral. I also think committee lanyards is another thing that I thought about, so that committees can actually have some authority and hold respect in events. I'd also be looking at giving you guys online banking, and that's something that we've wanted for a while now, and that will really improve all of the voluntary time and make a lot of the actions you have to do a lot less laborious and bureaucratic.
Thank you very much, Ruth. Okay, Matt, apparently we have a group question coming up, so what is it? Oh no, my apologies, apparently it's for Sam Marshall.
Yeah, this question is indeed for Sam Marshall, and it is, how can you justify the expense of a room just for RAG to count money, and how will this actually benefit student groups?
Now, this will massively benefit student groups. RAG counts the money that is raised by every society and every sports club, and they do this all on their own time without funding from the union. So I think it's really important that they do have a counting room that is secure, that they can have the cash in. There is a build, I don't know if all students are aware of this, but in 2019 there is going to be a new student union building, and there will be a lot more space in that. So the dedicated space for Kent RAG will be hopefully coming in then. But there are a lot of teaching rooms that aren't used by the university, and I would be wanting to lobby the university in the short term to use that space for RAG when they need it. It wouldn't be 24/7 booked for them. It would be booked for them when they need it as a priority, but it wouldn't be dedicated 24/7.
Thank you very much, Sam. Okay, Matthew, what's the next question?
I'd like to apologise for pronouncing the RAG Society wrong, and the next question is from Jasper. In your manifesto, you talk about free memberships for societies. Will the union be allocating funds based on the number of signed up members or on the basis of members who show up for events?
That question, I don't think it's for me, it's for Ruth, because I don't mention free societies in my manifesto. I disagree with the aspect of free societies, with the aspect of free membership for societies, because I believe that students should pay with their membership. They should pay because we have societies like MUN who need the money from membership. They need the money to go to travel and competitions. So it's not something I fundamentally believe in. I don't think it's part of my manifesto.
Okay, Jasper, so do you not feel, so do you feel that everybody has an obligation to pay towards their society, even if they're volunteering societies or protected societies, such as the LGBT?
Not an obligation, but if they're struggling to pay for a membership, the union does offer a scheme to give them the money for that membership, a grant. So students should have that access more, and they should promote it more. As students gain maintenance grants, for instance, it's a skill to budget which maintenance grants use. It's like, okay, I'm not going to buy a certain product today. I'm going to use that money to go on a membership. That membership will be used for the whole year. So make it really inclusive, and every money and every penny from societies goes back to your society. So your money is being used, well, whatever the circumstance. There's no reason for it to be free.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Okay, Matthew, what you got for us?
This question is for Ruth Wilkinson, and it is. You speak a lot about forum loyalty in your manifesto and how the current system is fractured. The current turnout for forum meetings is exceptionally low, even when the forum representative provides free pizza at the event. How do you plan to increase attendance to these meetings and get groups to engage in your forum competitions?
We would like to apologise for the technical difficulties there. That question is actually directed towards Sam. Apologies.
Jasper, sorry.
Well, the issue with forums at the moment is no one actually cares. That a forum rep is given £200 for the whole year to do a certain event or a certain meeting, and that money is not being used. So offering free pizza won't necessarily get people involved. What we need to do is build relations. Scheme in my manifesto is to do the Harry Potter House Cup style of a Forum of the Year scheme. Try and get societies to get their merits from each reward. So if they do like a competition, give them 100 points. Like reward them on this basis and just try and form these bonds. I also want to try and, if it's Cultural Night at Woody's, get £1 off based on your forum. You show them your membership and there you go. Like try and build this interconnected bond and make it really cohesive and inclusive.
Thank you very much, Jasper. KTV once again sincerely apologises for the mix-up. However, the show must go on. So, Matthew, what have you got for us?
Right, this question is for Michael Thompson, and it is, where will the funding for first aid come from?
That's a very good question. I feel that currently the funding scheme for societies for first aid has been set up to allow bigger societies to have more members of their team get more training for first aid. However, that severely limits smaller societies, such as many on the Special Interest Forum, to get any at all. That £20 per member is a lot to pay us for, especially considering some societies get in of maybe £40 to £50 in their first term and maybe another 20 on top of that in the second term. I feel that setting up so it allows for all societies, setting the payment
10 seconds
payment size for all societies would be a benefit to allow more people to be first aid trained and have a safer society.
Sorry, I've got to cut you off now. My apologies. Okay, Matthew, what else we got?
I have a question here for Jasper, which is, you want to reform the volunteering toolkit and how students log their hours. As the toolkit was developed by MSL, there are significant financial costs related to the modification of any features of the system. Where will the money come from to pay for these changes?
The money will come from certain companies. Now what we have is the student union with all these dedicated and passionate volunteers. And what we need is that social media presence to influence and market ourselves to external companies. Once we get investment from external companies, we'll be able to use that money to go into MSL and to try and reform the toolkit through this cost. If it's through logos or marketing or advertising, to try and show like other companies through our social media presence, through our actual ability and our forms, that here we go companies, we're going to work with you and we're going to empower our students with a reforms toolkit, and this is how we're going to benefit our future's careers.
Thank you, Jasper. A question for you though. You say that you want to go to external companies to get this funding, but external companies, although most of them are quite charitable, they're always going to want something in return. So what would you be prepared to give up in order to secure that funding?
Well, when you think about it, it's all politics. If a certain company wants money or advertising, if Nando's wants to promote themselves through forums or through our social media channels, then we give them that ability to reach out to students who are not in their minds. Like restaurants, for instance, in Canterbury, we have tons of restaurants like Tamago who offer all these deals for cultural societies. Try and get an investment from Tamago, get the cultural societies to invest their time in Tamago, Tamago rewards back, and in turn that relationship found a really effective change and bring investment for us.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Matthew, what else have you got for us?
I have a question here for Michael Thompson, and that is, how do you propose to improve committee elections?
Currently, the system that's been put in place means that all societies will have to have a committee election all in the same week, and it will all be online. What I propose is to allow for a standardised paper election system for societies who want to opt in for paper elections. There are many societies who have complained that they've had many problems with the online system in the past, and having all societies do their online committee elections on the same week on that online system would just put a lot of backlog and a lot of problems for a lot of societies who just don't feel like their feedback was respected when last year they complained about said system. And I think the option for a standardized paper election would be nice, because many societies want to do paper elections. And a standardized version would allow for an expediency for Kent Union to get back these election results in the form of paper, whereas before returning officers would just set up their elections for the societies they want, and it would all be reliant on a specific...
Sorry, I had to cut you off, but I do have a question for you. When it comes to switching to paper elections, do you not fear that will harm the integrity of the elections themselves, as it's a committee election? Who would handle that? Who would ensure that the ballots remain secret and that it remains fair throughout the entire process?
Not at all. I feel that when you're doing a standardized paper election, you should the person who votes should be able to put their name and Kent login on the paper to allow that to allow themselves to to vote in said election. They could even ahead of time ask the union to print off a list of members' specific papers for the election, so only specific papers are given back to societies. The actual tallying up of votes would be handled by Kent Union. So I feel that would be an impartial system in itself.
Thank you very much, Michael. So, Matthew, have you got any more questions snuck up that sleeve of yours?
Indeed I do. And this is a nice short question for a nice short sleeve. And it is for Ruth Wilkinson. And it is, who would fund the free tea and a coffee during exam season?
Kent Union have a fund to look after volunteers, and I actually think it's really important that we do appreciate that volunteers give a lot of time especially during stressful times like exam seasons. So the idea behind that is that we give a little something back. We do have a fund for that. That's how we fund the awards nights and things like that. So it would come out of that. It wouldn't necessarily have to be hugely costly, but I feel like it would give a little extra something just to keep you guys going through the long nights and hopefully acing your exams as well.
Thank you very much, Ruth. But what about those who don't necessarily drink tea or coffee or have a caffeine intolerance for whatever reason, be it religious, social, or even medical reasons? They won't get any benefit out of it. So how do you propose to get around that?
Well, I'm sure there's lots of alternatives that can be considered, like herbal teas, and even just maybe it's kind of more of a networking thing as well. So just providing sort of company and a place to go along and chat to the other volunteers, we can obviously consider all kinds of options of what we could actually provide and what the volunteers want.
Thank you, Ruth. Okay, and just to finish off this little round of questions, what have you got for us, Matthew?
Right, this question is for Sam Marshall, and it is, you talk about interacting with student media to provide coverage of society events. Are you unaware that student media already works very hard to cover this through its news, entertainment and sports departments in each society? How do you see your plans fitting into this?
I would just promote the fact that that was happening, because publicity-wise, I think a lot of societies aren't aware of it. I would be trying to encourage more and actually advising the societies that that opportunity was available for them. And actually, I will admit that I wasn't aware that that was already a thing, but it was something that was recommended to me by a member of student media themselves. So it was clearly an idea that had some gumption behind it.
Thank you very much. Just wondering, how would you propose to ensure that you fulfil this pledge of yours, this middleman role, without treading in any conflict of interest with the comms managers of individual societies?
With the what of individuals?
With any comms managers, PR officers.
Okay. I would just be acting as a middleman. I would be asking KTV when you're available. I would be asking societies if they've got any events that they want publicised, and then passing on the information in between. At no point would I ever be wanting to tell people what to do, because as VP activities, that's not your job. You are there as a platform. You are there to assist student volunteers in what they want to do and provide the opportunities.
Thank you very much. So now for the next round of questioning. Matthew, you ready for us?
Indeed I am, Liam, with a question for Ruth Wilkinson, and that is, do you think being on the Board of Trustees has made you institutionalised and less in touch with students?
Definitely not. I mean, the Board of Trustees is a board meeting every 2 months or so. That means I get to go and look at all the numbers, the nitty-gritty details, and think really strategically far in advance. But then my day role is I'm a volunteer. I'm a president of a club, so I run all the operational side of that. Lead a committee of volunteers. So I'm definitely very engaged with the volunteers. You'll find me in venue on a Wednesday night. I have not been institutionalised at all.
Thank you very much, Ruth. Okay, Matthew, what's next?
This next question is for Michael Thompson, and that is, students already receive emails about the possibilities that KSCV and the Toolkit offer. Which steps would you undertake concretely to raise its visibility among the students?
I was unaware that KSCV and Toolkit get emails from them, but that is in and of itself a problem. Like, there are many students who I feel just don't know about this system. Like, I talked to many students in the Special Interest Forum who run societies, and they were unaware that these systems, like Toolkit and KSCV, which is the same system, were there to log volunteering hours for societies for both core committee and non-core committee. I feel it'd be important to, like, just make it aware that, like, during Freshers Week and during committee training, like, just being aware that you are told that these systems are in place, because many students log in many hours of societies every week and just don't know that they could be possibly getting something in back for their hard work.
Thank you very much, Michael. Okay, and for the last question this round, please.
Right, this is for Sam Marshall, and it is, how are you going to fund your free passes to society events?
It wouldn't require very little funding, to be honest. The idea behind this is that at the start of each term, each student would get a limited number of free passes. And this is just mostly to give students almost permission to go to society events. Society events are accessible all around the time for the whole year. But most students feel uncomfortable doing that, approaching a society midway through the term. They feel like friendships are already formed. If free passes are issued, then they could use these, go to the society events, and then the reward at the end, society-wise, would be that there would be, I'm thinking, a £50 extra funding for the society with the most amount of passes per term. So funding-wise, there's very little that would go into that, but it would encourage more engagement with societies.
Thank you very much. So, candidates look pretty beaten from all the questioning, but we still have one more round left for questions for them. So, Matthew, care to help me finish this off with a bang?
Right, this question is for Jasper, and it is, how would you see your policy to get deals with Kent Union outlets based on forums and their loyalties working? Would this create favouritism between societies in the eyes of Kent Union?
No, I don't think I always do favouritism within Kent Union. I am currently working in Essentials, and I have relations with the manager and the departments within Essentials so that I can try and inspire this change within these outlets. I can show them, and I have that relationship. So here you go, you can get money off a certain cultural product if you're part of a cultural forum. Or if it's an academic, if you get a certain money off your pens or stationery or whatever your needs are. Even in Woody's, if Woody's are desperate for that investment. So if we say, Woody's, if you hold this night and if you get money off certain volunteers, all you need to do is show a screenshot of your memberships, and then that will bring this network together of people like being really cohesive and actually talking, and something which they're not doing in the forum system at the moment.
Thank you very much, Jasper. The next question, please.
Right. We've had more come in, and the next question is for Sam Marshall, and it is, how do you think societies can afford these trips that you suggest?
I'm assuming this is in reference to the day trip manifesto point. And actually, if you look on my Facebook page, I did put on a full description of what I mean by this. So this year, the UKC Travel Society has had massive success. They've been really oversubscribed, and they've been really trying to provide as many opportunities for students to go on these trips as possible. If elected, I would want to work with the Travel Society and have discussed this with their committee to try and subsidise the cost a little to allow more opportunity. But mostly it wouldn't be the societies funding the trips, it would be the students wanting to participate in the trips, with Kent Union subsidising this in a small amount.
Thank you very much. And my, the questions are flying in now. Matthew, you might as well just be doing a raffle. So, what's next on the list?
Right, next on the list is Ruth Wilkinson, and it is, what's your stance on initiations? Are they dangerous and irresponsible, or just fun that the union shouldn't intervene on?
I don't think the union shouldn't intervene. I think it's a really careful line that we have to tread. I don't like the term initiations. I think welcome event works a lot better, and there's no reason why there couldn't be fun and games. But it is really important that those games are safe and that they're not going to make anybody feel unwelcome. I'm really behind the idea that we do ask the clubs and societies to give us a risk assessment, give us an outline of the games that they intend, because that means we have more of an idea, and it means that if anything, you know, that is really outrageous is being planned, that we can step in and advise any kind of changes that that we think we should make.
Thank you very much, Ruth. Okay, what's up next, Matthew?
Up next is a question from Michael Thompson, and that is there a culture of irresponsible drinking amongst student activities? How will you tackle this?
Personally, I don't feel there is a culture of irresponsible drinking amongst student activities, at least not with the societies that I'm familiar with. Most societies that I'm familiar with, most societies are open, are even close to the idea of drinking during the society, because it's just irresponsible in some cases and can affect the event or night they're hosting. And in other cases, whilst they are open to drinking, societies generally just ask their students to be polite, and just like, and our committees should be able to just ask their students to just. Who are being irresponsible with their drink, to just leave, and even be aware that Campus Watch is around at all times to help with these matters.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, Matthew, what's next?
Thank you, Liam. And this next question is coming in from Twitter, and it is from @AndyLoweth with the hashtag CQTActivities, and it's, mature students make up around 20% of students. What would you do for the mature student community? And this is for all the candidates in the room.
Okay, Ruth. You're up.
Okay, I'm going first. Okay, so actually I did post on my Facebook page today that very statistic, 20% of students are mature students. And actually I think it's really important that the VP activities is behind societies and the campaigns that they want to run. So one of the things that I've chatted to some mature students and they said they've been campaigning for ages for a mature students common room. And actually I think there was some debacle a few years ago where they did get some funding and then it didn't happen. So I would absolutely be behind the campaign for the mature students to get a common room. If that's what they wanted, I would be there in the role of VP activities to support them with that.
Thank you. But do you not feel that would be divisive between postgraduates and undergraduates?
I think it's really important to consider all of these kind of different demographics and things like that. I mean, there's no reason why a common room like JCR that's totally underused couldn't be made into, you know, like a joint use. There's no reason why it would have to be specifically only mature students. I'm sure they're not going to ID you when you go in. And there's no reason why sort of groups like this couldn't have joint sort of access to resources.
Thank you very much, Ruth. Okay, Michael, it's your turn.
The mature student community in Kent is quite large and very well and makes up an incredible part of the Kent society community. And I feel that that their representation is... I'm sorry, I'm not sure what to say for this question.
That's fine. Okay, well, we'll move on to Jasper then.
For the mature students, what we need to do is launch a review into what volunteering they're going in for and what societies they're actually interested in. So if the mature students are going towards, and they're not aware of certain programmes that Kent Union are actually promoting, we need to make them aware. We need to use social media to our advantage with these mature students and try and show them with this community. Now, a large part of my manifesto is showing that a lot of international students are neglected, and a lot of these are our international mature students. The mature students have this huge, like, skill set of language. They can speak dual languages. So what we need is a language exchange system so they can use their skills and their investment together with other societies and the other society members.
Thank you, Jasper. So with that, you're saying that you want to promote specific societies that they're interested in, but don't you feel that some kind of favoritism towards specific societies, maybe even the bigger ones over the little ones?
It's not really favouritism then, it's using like a focus, like making someone that they're aware. If we just give them like a whole blanket and all these logos, they won't be interested in it because there's nothing spotlighted, there's nothing focused on a certain area. If they're interested in learning a language, the university discourages that with these high expensive costs. What we need is a system which builds on the Kent Buddy system, which I'll work with the VP of Welfare to try and get that system of language up, get that system of culture, so they feel really unified in their union. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jasper. Sam, it's your turn.
So having spoken to the Mature Students Society myself, I know they do indeed want a common room, and I know that previously they had been given by the university a common room that was jointly used by other people. They didn't like this idea, and I completely agree with them. The university thinks that it would be divisive to have a common room completely for mature students, but I think it is important that you recognise that they are of a much different age. They do have very different interests to undergrads, not always, but in a lot of circumstances. And I think it is important for them to have a room where they go and can talk to people that of a similar age, of similar interests. I'll often see them in K-Bar having a drink in the afternoon or a pizza, and I know that they very much feel like they don't have anywhere to go on campus. I would also want to try and improve the Welcome Week events for mature students. At the minute, Freshers Week is you get very drunk and there's not much else to do. I would want to put on more events that mature students would be more inclined to go to, that are calmer, not all about drinking.
Thank you very much, Sam. So you've kind of put almost a general spread that because they're older, that maybe they're less inclined to drink. But what about those who probably still like that experience? Do you not feel that's kind of excluding them as a group?
Oh, I'm sorry if I gave that impression. That was not at all what I mean. I see them in K-Bar quite a lot, but they like a drink. They love their ale in particular. But it's more about pub drinking as opposed to club drinking was the difference I was trying to make with my point there. And I do think there are a lot of undergrads that would appeal to as well. So it could actually foster some more integration between undergrads who perhaps don't like to go out drinking and dancing a lot and mature students that they might have more some similar interests with.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so To finish off, I'm afraid that we're finally out of questions. I'd like to thank the candidates for VP Activities for being here and being happily grilled. I'd also like to thank my co-host Matthew, who's been working at the Social Media Centre. And just before we sign off, I'm just going to remind you that we have the presidential candidate question time tomorrow. And we really, really are looking forward to that. It's the biggest event that we've had so far. And in order for us to make that as big as possibly as we possibly can, we need the questions. We need questions from you guys, the people who are going to be voting. And once again, in order to do this, all you need to do is go onto the Kent Union website. That's www.kentunion.co.uk/leadership-elections. Or you can message us on Twitter using the @Kent_TV handle and then using the hashtag CQTPresident. My name's Liam Mayer, and I'm signing off, and also Matthew. Okay, goodbye.